For My Lady's Heart. Written by Laura Kinsale. Narrated by Nicholas Bolton. Author's note. I've provided a glossary for this audiobook as a small glimpse into the fascinating history of our language. Some of the words have other definitions, but here they are limited to the meanings that I used in this book. I've given alternate spellings and some grammar hints for those of you who like to go around talking to your friends this way. You know who you are. The PDF glossary may be downloaded from www.hedgehoginc.com or the book's page at www.laurakinsale.com. Have fun, Laura. For My Lady's Heart. These old gentle Britons in their days of diverse adventures they made lays, rhymed in their first Briton tongue, which lays with their instruments they sung, or else read them for their pleasance, and one of them have I in remembrance, which I shall say with good will as I can. But, sires, by cause I am a Burrell man, at my beginning first I you beseech, have me excused of my rude speech. I learned never rhetoric certain, thing that I speak, it must be bare and plain. The Prologue of the Franklin's Tale, from the Canterbury Tales, by Geoffrey Chaucer. Prologue.
Where werre and rake and wonder, besithes hath wont therein, and oft both a blisse and blunder, full skate hath skifted sin. Where war and rack and wonder, by sides have been therein, and oft both bliss and blunder, full swift have shifted since.
Prologue. Sir Gawain and the Green Knight. The pilgrims looked at the sky and the woods and each other. Anywhere but at the woman in the ditch. The free companies ruled these forests. Her screeching might draw unwelcome attention. As she rolled in the wagon rut, grinding dirt into her hair, crying out pious revelations with shrieks and great weepings, her companions leaned against trees and squatted in the shade, sharing a vessel of warm beer. Remote thunder murmured as heat clouds piled up over the endless grim forests of France. It was high summer of the 9th year after the great pestilence. A few yards from the sobbing female, on the high grassy center of the road, a priest sat removing his sandals and swatting dust off his soles one by one. Now and then, someone glanced into the dark woods. The girl had prophesied that their party of English pilgrims would reach Avignon safe, and though she was prostrated by holy ecstasies in this manner a dozen times a day, moved by the turn of a leaf or the flicker of a sunbeam to fall to her knees in wailing, it was true that they'd not seen or heard a suspicion of outlaws since she'd joined the party at Reims.
"John Hardy," she moaned,
and a man who'd just taken hold of the bottle looked round with dismay. He drank a deep swig and said,
"Nay, sermon me not, good sister."
The woman sat up.
"I shall so sermon thee, John Hardy."
She wiped at her comely young face, her bright eyes glaring out from amid streaks of dirt.
"Thou art intemperate with beer. God is offended with thee."
John Hardy stood up, taking another long drink.
"And thou art a silly girl stuffed with silly conceits. What—"
A crash of thunder and a long, shrill scream overwhelmed his words. The devout damsel threw herself back down to the ground.
"There," she shouted, "hearest thou the voice of God? I am a prophet. Our Lord forewarneth thee. Take any drink but pure water in peril of eternal damnation, John Hardy."
The rain clouds rolled low overhead, casting a green dullness on her face. She startled back as a single raindrop struck her.
"His blood!"
She kissed her palm.
"His precious blood!"
"Be naught but the storm overtaking us, thou great fool woman!"
John Hardy swung on the others with vehemence.
"I'm a prophet,"
he mocked in a high, agitated voice.
"Belie me if she be not a heretic in our very midst. I'm on to shelter ere I'm drowned. Who'll be with me?"
The whole company was fervently with him. As they prepared to start on their way, The girl bawled out the sins of each member of the party as they were revealed to her by God. The intemperance of John Hardy, the godless laughing and jesting of Mistress Park, the carnal lusting of the priest, and the meat on Friday consumed by Thomas O'Link. The accused ignored her, taking up the long liripipes that dangled from the crests of their hoods, and wrapping the headgear tight as the rain began to fall in earnest. The party moved on into the sudden downpour. The woman could have caught up easily, but she stayed in the ditch, shrieking after them. In the thunderous gloom, the rain began to run in sheets and little streams into the road. She stayed crying, reaching out her hands to the empty track. The last grey outline of the stragglers disappeared around the bend. A waiting figure detached itself from the shadows beneath the trees. The young knight walked to the edge of the rut and held out his hand. Rain plastered his black hair and moulded a fustian pilgrim's robe to his back and shoulders, showing chainmail beneath.
"They ne hearketh to me," she sobbed. "They taken no heed."
"Ye drove them off, Isabel," he said tonelessly.
"It is their wickedness. They nill heed me. I was having a vision like to St. Gertrude's."
His gauntleted hand still held steady, glistening with raindrops.
"Is it full finished now?"
"Certes it is finished," she said testily,
allowing him to pull her to her feet. She stepped out of the ditch, leaving her shoe. The knight got down on his knees, his mail chinking faintly, and fished the soggy leather out of a puddle already growing in the mud. She leaned on his shoulder and thrust her foot inside the slipper, wriggling forcefully. He smoothed the wet wrinkles up her ankle. His hand rested on her calf for a moment, and she snatched her leg away.
"None of that, sir!"
He lifted his face and looked at her. The rain slipped off strong, dark brows and dewed on his black lashes. He was 17 and already carried fighting scars, but none visible on his upturned features. Water coursed down, outlining his hard mouth and the sullen cast of his green eyes. The girl pushed away from him sharply.
"I believe thou art Satan himself, sir, if thou wilt stare at me so vile."
Without a word, he got to his feet, readjusting the sword at his hip, before he walked away to a bay horse tethered in the shadow of the trees. He brought the stallion up to her.
"Will ye ride?"
"The Lord Jesus commanded me to walk to Jerusalem."
"Ride," he said, "until we come up with the company once more."
"It were evil for me to ride in. I mote walk."
"This forest hides evil enow," he said harshly. "Now would I have us tarry alone here."
"Fear not, in the valley of shadow and death," she intoned, catching his hand.
She fell to the sodden ground, her wet robe clinging to the feminine contour of her breasts.
"Kneel with me. I see the Virgin. Her light shineth all about us. Oh, the sweet heavenly light."
She closed her eyes, turning up her face. Her tears began to mingle with the raindrops.
"Isabel," he cried, "now cannot we linger here alone? For God's love, move freshly now."
He grabbed her arm and pulled her up. By main force, he threw her across the saddle in spite of her struggle. She began to screech, her wet legs bared, sliding from his mailed grip. The horse shied, and she tumbled off the other side. He jerked the reins, barely holding the stallion back from trampling her as it tried to bolt. She lay limp in the grass. As he dropped to his knees beside her, she rolled feebly onto her back, moaning.
"Lady!"
He leaned over her.
"Isabel, lovely, ye be not harmed."
She opened her eyes, staring past him.
"So sweet, so wondrous sweet the light."
Rain washed the mud from her face. Her fair blue eyes held a dreamy look, her lashes spiky with wetness, her lips smiling faintly. The pilgrim's hood had fallen open, showing a white, smooth curve of throat. He hung motionless above her a moment, looking down. Her gaze snapped to his. She shoved at him and scrambled away.
Thou thinkest deadly sin. My love is for the Lord God alone.
The young knight flung himself to his feet. He caught his horse with one hand and the girl with the other, dragging them together.
Mount,
he commanded, baring his teeth with a savagery that cowed her into grasping the stirrup.
I ne will,
she said, trying to turn away.
Will ye or nill ye?
He hiked her foot, catching her off balance, and propelled her up. She yelped, landing pillion in the high-cantled war saddle, clutching for security as he swung the wild-eyed horse around. The stallion followed him, neck stretched, the black mane lying in sloppy, thick straggles against the animal's skin. The knight hauled his horse a few yards down the verge through the wet grass and mud. He stopped, facing stiffly away from her into the rain.
I am not Satan himselfwin, he said. I'm your wedded husband, Isabel.
I am wed to Christ, she said righteously, and oft revealed the truth to thee, sir. Thou hast thy way with me against my will and God's.
He stood still, looking straight ahead.
6 months, he said stonily. My true wife ye hast ne been in that time.
Her voice softened a little.
To use me so were the death of thee, husband. So I've prophesied oft and oft.
He slogged forward. The horse slipped and splashed through a puddle, sending water up, causing the knight's fustian robe to cling over the plated greaves and cuisses that protected his legs. The rain swelled into huge drops. Hail began to spatter against his shoulders, bouncing in pea-sized pebbles off his bared black hair. He made an inarticulate sound and dragged the stallion to the edge of the wood, stopping beneath a massive tree. Isabel and the horse took up the protected space beneath the heaviest branch, leaving him with the filter of sodden leaves above to break the hail. She began an exhortation on the sins of the flesh, and detailed a vision of hell recently visited upon her. From this she went on to a revelation of Jesus on the cross, which, she assured him, God had told her was superior in its brilliance to the similar sight described by Bridget of Sweden. When a hailstone the size of a walnut cracked him on the skull, he cursed aloud and yanked his helmet from the saddle. Isabel reproved him for his impious language. He pulled the conical bassinet down over his head. The visor fell shut. He leaned against the tree trunk with a dismal clang, a faceless, motionless, wordless suit of armor, while his wife told a parable of her own devising, in which a man who used ungodly maledictions was condemned to dwell in hell with fiery rats for ever eating out his tongue. The music of the hailstones pattered in tinny, uneven notes on steel. She had finished the parable and gone on to predicting what sort of vermin they might expect to find among the infidels when the storm began to lift, leaving the forest and the grassy verge steaming in greens and greys. Light shone on the watery ruts in two twisted ribbons of silver. Like a frost of snow, hail lay amid the foliage, already beginning to melt. The knight pulled off his helmet and tried unsuccessfully to dry it on his robe. Without speaking, he pushed away from the tree and began to walk again, tugging the horse through small lakes beside the road, his spurs catching in the muddy weeds. Vapor rose from his shoulders. Isabel plucked at her sodden robe, holding it away from her skin as she talked. She was describing the present state of her soul in considerable detail when he stopped suddenly and turned to her. A breaking shaft of sunlight caught him, banishing the sullen shadows. He looked up at her, young and earnest, interrupting her eloquence.
Isabel, say me this.
He paused, staring at her intensely.
If outlaws were to fall upon us this moment and ransom my life against...
The youthfulness vanished from his face in a set scowl.
Against this, that ye takes me again into your bed as husband. Then what would you? Would ye see me slayed?
Her lips pinched.
What vain tale is this?
Say the truth of your heart, he insisted. My life for your vaunted chastity. What best to be done?
She glared at him.
Thou art a sinner, Ruck.
The truth!
He shouted passionately.
Have ye no love left for me?
His words echoed back from the forest, enticement enough to outlaws. But he stood, waiting, rigid, with his hand on the bridle. She began to sway slightly. She lifted her eyes to the glowing clouds.
"Alas," she said gently, "but I love thee so steadfast, husband. It were better to beholden thee put to death before my eyes than we should yielden again to that uncleanness in the eyes of God."
His gaze did not leave her. He stared at her unblinking, his body still as stone. She smiled at him and reached down to touch his hand.
"Revelation will come to thee."
He caught her fingers and gripped them in his, holding them hard in his armored glove.
"Isabel," he said, in a voice like ruin.
With her free hand, she crossed herself.
"Let us make troth of chastity both together. Thee I do love dearly, as a mother loveth her son."
He let go of her. For a moment, he looked about him in a bewildered way, as if he could not think what to do. Then, abruptly, he began to walk again, pulling the horse in silence. A cool wind out of the storm caught the knight's dark hair, drying it, blowing it against his ears. The breeze faltered for a moment, playing and veering. The horse threw up its head. Its nostrils flared. The knight came alert. He stopped, his hand on his sword hilt. The animal planted its feet, drinking frantically at the uneasy wind, staring at the curve ahead where the road disappeared into deep woods. There was only silence and the breeze.
"The Lord God is with us,"
Isabel said loudly. Nothing answered. No arrow flew. No foe came rushing upon them from ambush.
"Get ye after the hind bow!"
The knight shoved his helmet down on his head and threw the reins over the horse's ears. As Isabel floundered out of his way over the cantle, he mounted. She flung her arms about his waist. With his sword drawn, he drove his spurs into the nervous stallion, sending it into a sprint with a war cry that resounded in volleys from the trees. The horse cannoned along the road, with water flying from its hooves, sweeping round the curve at the howling height of the knight's battle shout. The sight that met them was no more than a flicker of red mud and slaughter as the horse cleared the first body in a great leap. The animal tried to bolt, but the knight dragged it to a dancing halt amid the stillness. He said nothing, turning and turning the horse in an agitated circle. The butchered bodies of their former companions wheeled past beneath his gaze, around and around, white dead faces and crimson that ran fresher than the rain. Isabel clung to him.
"God spared us," she said with a breathless tone. "Swear now before Jesus our Saviour that thou wilt live and chaste."
He reined the horse hastily among the bodies, leaning down to look for signs of life as the animal pranced in uneasy rhythm, its hooves squelching wet grass and gore. The looters had done thorough work.
"God's blood! They've been slain but a moment."
His voice was tight as he scanned the dark encroaching forest.
"The brigands be scarce flown."
He turned the stallion away, but at the edge of the clearing, he doubled the horse back on the grisly scene again, as if he had not looked upon it long enough to believe.
"Unshriven they died," Isabel whispered, and murmured a prayer.
She had never let go of her grip on his arm, not even to cross herself.
"Swear thee now, in thanks for God's mercy and deliverance, thou wilt be chaste evermore."
He was breathing hard, pushing air through his teeth as he looked at what was left of Mistress Park.
"I swear," he said.
He yanked the horse around and spurred it away down the road in a gallop for their lives. Avignon intimidated and disgusted him. In the murky, baking streets below the palace of the Pope, he stood stoically as Isabel prayed aloud before a splinter of the true cross. Behind her back, a whore with bad skin beckoned to him, striking licentious poses in the doorway, folding her hands in mockery, running her tongue about her dark lips, while Isabel knelt weeping in the unswept dirt. His wife had barely warmed to her devotions, he knew from experience, when the toothless purveyor of the holy relic grew impatient and demanded in crudely descriptive English that she buy it or take herself off. The whore laughed at Isabel's look of shock. Ruck scowled back and put his hand on his wife's shoulder more gently than he might have.
"Bide ye not with these hypocrites," he said. "Come."
She stumbled to her feet and stayed near him, uncharacteristically quiet as they made their way through the crowds. The shadow of the palace fell over them, a massive wall rising sheer above the narrow cobbled street, pocked with arrow slits styled in the shapes of crosses, the fortifications crowned by defensive crenels. Isabel's body pressed against him. He put his arm about her, shoving back at a stout friar who tried to elbow her aside in passing. She felt cool and soft under his hand. He was blistering hot in his chainmail and fustian, but dared not leave the armor off and untended as they moved from shrine to shrine, kissing saints' bones and kneeling before images of the Virgin, with Isabel's tears and cries echoing around the sepulchres. Now this new shrinking, her snugging against him, fitting into the circle of his arm as she'd been used to do, made piety even more difficult to maintain. He tried to subdue his lustful thoughts. He prayed as they joined the stream of supplicants forging up the slope to the palace gate. But he was not such a hand at it as Isabel. She'd always been a chatterer. It was her voice that had first caught his attention in the Coventry market. A pretty voice, and a pretty burgher's daughter, with a giddy laugh and a smile that made his knees weak. He'd felt amazed to win her with nothing to offer but the plans and dreams he lived on as if they were meat and bread. But there had been only a few sweet weeks of kissing and bedding, with Isabel as loving and eager for it as himself, before the king's army had called him to France. When he'd come back, knighted on the field at Poitiers, full of the future, triumphant and appalled, and eager to bury himself and the bloodshed in the clean, tender arms of his wife, he'd come back and found that God had turned her dizzy prattle into prophecy. For a seven-night he'd had his way with her, in spite of the weeping, in spite of the praying and begging, in spite of the scolds, but when she'd taken to screaming, he'd found it more than he could endure. He'd thought he ought to beat her. That was her father's advice, and sure it was that Ruck would gladly beat her, or mayhap even strangle her when she was in the full flow of pious exhortations. But instead, she'd beseeched him to take her on pilgrimage across the heap of war-torn ruins that was France. And here he was, not certain if it was God's will or a girl's, certain only that his heart was full of lechery, and his body seethed with need. They entered the palace through an arch beneath two great conical towers, passing under them to an immense courtyard, larger than any castle he'd ever seen, teeming with beggars and clergy and hooded travellers. The clerics and finer folk seemed to know where to go. The plain pilgrims like themselves wandered with aimless bafflement, or joined a procession that ran twice around the perimeter and ended at a knot of priests and clerks. Isabel began to tremble in his arms. He felt her bones dissolve. She sank from his grip to the pavement, with 100 pairs of feet scuffing busily past. As her wail rose above the noise, people began to pause. Ruck was growing inured to it. He even began to see the advantages. Not a quarter hour elapsed before they had a church official escorting them past the more mundane supplicants, and into a great columned and vaulted chamber full of people. The echoing roar of discourse stopped his ears. The ceiling arched above, studded with brilliant golden stars on a blue field, and painted with figures bearing scrolls. He recognized St. John and the 20 prophets. His eyes kept sliding upward, drawn by the gilded radiance, the vivid color. Abruptly, the clerk pushed him, and he collapsed onto a bench. Isabel looked back over her shoulder at him with her hand outstretched and her mouth open, as she and her escort were engulfed by the crowd.
Isabel!
Ruck jumped to his feet. He shoved after them. She had been named heretic for her sermoning more than once. He had to stay near her, explain her to the wary and suspicious. He floundered into a clearing and found himself in the midst of a circle of priests in rich vestments. The robed and tonsured scribe looked up from the lectern with a scowl, The plaintiff ceased his petition and turned, still kneeling before the podium. Ruck backed out of the gathered court, bowing hastily. He turned and strained to his full height, a head taller than most, looking out over the massed assembly. But Isabel was gone. A guard stopped him at a side door and pretended not to understand Ruck's French, gesturing insolently at the benches. He glared back, repeating himself, raising his voice to a shout. The guard made an obscene gesture with his finger and jerked his chin again toward the benches. A shimmer of color sparkled at the corner of Ruck's eye. He turned his head reflexively, as if a mirror had flashed. Space had opened around him. At the edge of it, 2 spears' length distant, a lady paused. She glanced at him and the guard as she might glance at mongrels scrapping. A princess, mayhap a queen from the richness of her dress and jewels, surrounded by her attendants, male and female, secluded amid the crowd like a glitter of silent prismatic light among shadows. Cold. And as her look skimmed past him, his whole body caught ice and fire. He dropped to one knee, bowing his head. When he lifted it, the open space had closed, but still he could see her within the radius of her courtiers. They appeared to be waiting like everyone else, conversing among themselves. One of the men gave Ruck a brief, scornful lift of his brow and turned his shoulder eloquently. Ruck came to a sense of himself. He sat down on the bench by the guard, but he could not keep his gaze away from her. At first he tried, examining the pillars and carved animals, the other pilgrims, a passing priest, in between surreptitious glances at her. But none in her party looked his way again. Concealed among the throng and the figures passing in and out the door, he allowed himself to stare. She carried a hooded white falcon, as indifferently as if the Pope's hall had been a hunting field. Her throat and shoulders gleamed pale against a jade gown fashioned like naught he'd seen in his life, cut low, hugging her waist and hips without a concealing cotardie, embroidered down to her hem with silver dragonflies, each one with a pair of jeweled emerald eyes, so that the folds sparkled with her every move. A dagger hung on her girdle, smoothed ivory crusted with malachite and rubies. Lavish silver liripipes, worked in a green and silver emblem that he didn't recognize, draped from her elbows to the floor. Green ribbons with the same emblem laced her braids, lying against hair as black as the black heavens, coiled smooth as a devil's coronet. He watched her hands because he could not bear to look long at her face, and did not dare to scan her body for its violent effect on his. The gauntlet and the falcon's hood, bejeweled like all the rest of her, glittered with emeralds on silver. She stroked the bird's breast with white fingers. And from 4 rods away, that steady, gentle caress made him bleed as if from a mortal wound in his chest. She turned to someone, lifting her finger to hold back the gauzy green veil that fell from her crown of braids to her shoulder. A feminine gesture, a delicacy that commanded and judged and condemned him to an agony of desire. He could not tear his look from her hand as it hovered near her lips. He saw her slight smile for her ladies. So cold. Cold. She was bright cold. He was ferment. He couldn't comprehend her face. He hardly knew if she was comely or unremarkable. He could not at that moment have described her features any more than he could have looked straight at the sun to describe it.
Husband!
Isabel's voice shocked him. She was there. She caught his hand, falling on her knees beside the bench.
The bishop speaketh with me on the morrow, to hear in my confession, and discourse together as God's servants.
Her blue eyes glowed as she clutched a pass that dangled wax seals. She smiled up at him joyfully.
I told him of thee, Ruck, that thou hast been my good and faithful protector, and he bids thee come on also before him, to confirm thy solemn vow of chastity in the name of Jesus and the Virgin Mary.
Isabel insisted that he leave off his armor for the interview with the bishop. Her brief timidity, her snugging against Ruck for protection, had vanished. All night she'd sat up praying, pausing only to describe in endless particular the triumph of her examination by the clerks and officials. They had heard of her, her fame had really spread so far, and wished to prove to their own satisfaction that her visions were of God. They had questioned her fiercely, but she'd known every proper answer, and even given them back some of their own by pointing out an error in their orthodoxy concerning the Testament of St. James. Ruck had listened with a deep uneasiness inside him. He could not imagine that those arrogant churchmen, with their bright vestments and Latin intonations, had been won over by his wife. Isabel attracted a certain number of adherents, but they were of kindred mind to her, inclined to ecstasies and spiritual torments. He had not seen a single cleric here who gave the appearance of being any more interested in holy ecstasy than in his dinner. He'd slept fitfully, dreaming of falcons and female bodies, waking fully aroused. For an instant he'd groped for Isabel, and then opened his eyes and seen her kneeling at the window next to a sleeping tailor. Tears coursed silently down her cheeks. She looked so radiant and anxious, her eyes lifted to the dawn sky, her hands gripped together, that he felt helpless. He wanted this bishop to give her whatever it was that she desired. Sainthood, if she asked for it. He dreaded the interview. He was afraid as he'd never been before a fight. He felt as if he were facing execution. As long as that vow had been private, between him and Isabel, it had not seemed quite real. There was always the future. There were mitigating circumstances. He had not spoken clearly just what he swore to. She might change her mind. They were neither of them so very old yet. Women were erratic, that was known certainly enough. He ought to have beaten her. He ought to have put up with the screams and got her with a child. He ought to have told her that decent women stayed home and didn't drag their husbands over the face of creation in pursuit of canonization. He watched her prayerful tears, his luffsome, his sweet Isabel, and could have wept himself. In the great audience hall, he was informed he must wait, that only Isabel was required. A hunchbacked man held out his hand, leaning on his staff, and Ruck put a coin in it. He got a mute nod in return. All the morning he sat there, feeling naked in his leather gambeson without armour over it, swallowing down apprehension and despair. There was no way he could find out of the thing short of disavowing his own words and revealing himself a false witness in public, before a bishop of the church. Worse, he was afraid that they might trap him into it, perplex him with religious questions, and turn him about like a spinning top, as Isabel could do, until he swore whatever they wished. Three clerks came for him. He rose and followed them through corridors and upstairs, until they entered a high, square room. His blood beat in his ears. He had an impression of silence and intense colour, frescoes on all the walls, and many vividly dressed people, before he followed the clerks with his head bared and lowered. He went down on his knees before the bishop, without ever looking into the man's face.
"Sir Ruadric d'Angleterre,"
the modulated voice spoke in French. Soft slippers and the gold-banded hem of white and red robes were all Ruck could see.
"Is it your will that your wife take the veil and the ring to live chaste henceforth?"
Ruck stared at the slippers. The veil. He lifted his eyes as high as the bishop's knees. Isabel had never said anything about taking... Was she to leave him? Go into a nunnery?
"He hath sworn!"
Isabel's ardent voice reverberated off the high walls. She spoke English, but the interpreter's French words came like a murmured echo.
"Silence, daughter," the bishop said. "Thy husband must speak."
Ruck felt them all looking at him, a crowd of strangers at his back. He hadn't been prepared for this. He felt as if a great hand gripped his throat.
"Do you understand me, Sire Ruadric? Your wife desires to take the vow of chastity and retire to a life of contemplation. A placement can be made for her among the Franciscans at Saint-Cloud, if her situation is your concern."
"Saint-Cloud," he repeated stupidly. He lifted his eyes to find the bishop regarding him with an inquisitive look.
Do you understand French? The prelate asked.
Yea, my lord, Ruck said.
The bishop nodded in approval.
The wife hath not the power of her own body, but the husband. Likewise also the husband hath not power of his own body, but the wife, he intoned. As St. Paul saith to the Corinthians, she must receive your consent to do this. Is it your will, my son, that your wife take these vows to be chaste?
They were asking his permission. He could say no. He turned his head, and Isabel was standing wringing her hands, weeping as she had in the dawn, pleading with him silently. Isabel. Lovelich. He imagined denying her, holding her by force, imagined saying yes, and losing her forever. She made a deep moan in her throat, as if she were dying, and held out her hands to him in supplication. He turned his face away from her. He bent his head.
Yea, my lord,
he said harshly to the slippers and the golden hem. The bishop leaned forward. Ruck clasped his hands and put them in the holy man's cool grasp, sealing his consent. Now he had no wife. No true wife. He didn't know if he was married or not.
You may rise, my son, the bishop said.
Ruck stood. He started to bow and move back, but the prelate raised his hand.
Sire Roderick, do you believe this woman's visions are given to her by God?
He asked mildly.
Yea, my lord.
Ruck knew well enough to answer that in a firm voice. Any other reply he felt could be twisted to mean that they were hell-inspired.
You follow her in preachings on that account?
She's my wife, Ruck said, and then felt a flush of embarrassment rise in his face. She was. My lord, I could not let her go so far alone.
You did not require her to stay modestly at home?
He stood in shame, unable to admit that he'd found it impossible to command his own wife.
Her visions enjoin her, he said desperately. She is God's own servant.
His words died away into a profound silence. He felt they were laughing at him, to offer that as an excuse.
And you have given a solemn vow of chastity to her some 5 weeks past, on the road from Reims?
Ruck gazed helplessly at the bishop.
In obedience to this woman's visions, the bishop repeated insistently, you lived chaste in your marriage?
Ruck lowered his face.
Yea,
he mumbled, staring at the bright floor tiles.
My lord.
Oh, I think not, said a light female voice. He is not chaste. Indeed, he is an adulterer.
Ruck stiffened at this astonishing accusation.
Nay, I am not.
His fierce denial died on his tongue as he turned to find the lady with the falcon standing not a rod behind him. She strolled forward, sliding a glance at him over her shoulder, while she dropped a token reverence toward the bishop. Her eyes were light, not quite perfect blue, but saturated with the lilac tinge of her dress, and lined by black lashes. She seemed ageless, as young as Isabel and as old as iniquity. The emeralds on the falcon's hood glittered. Ruck felt his face aflame.
I have not adulterated, he said hoarsely.
Is not the thought as sinful as the deed, father?
She asked, addressing the bishop but looking at Ruck, her voice clear enough for her words to resonate from the walls.
That is true, my lady. But if you have no earthly evidence, it is a matter of absolution between a man and his confessor.
Of course,
she smiled that serene and indifferent smile, lifting her skirts, withdrawing.
I fear that I presumed too far. I wished only to spare your holiness the mockery of hearing a solemn vow of chastity made by such a man. He stared at me full bold yesterday in the hall of great audience, causing me much uneasiness of mind.
A low sound of protest escaped Ruck's throat, but he could not deny it. He had stared. He had committed adultery in his heart. He had desired her with an inordinate desire, a mortal passion. Her eyes met his as she retired gracefully to one side. He read absolute knowledge there. She laid him bare, and she knew that he knew it.
"I am grieved to hear that you have had any cause for annoyance in the house of God, my lady," the prelate said, not sounding particularly disturbed. "Modesty in manner and dress, daughter, will temper the boldness of ungodly men toward you. But your point is well taken with regard to the vow. Sire Roderick, can you swear to your purity, both in thought and in deed?"
Ruck thought God himself must be subjecting him to this mortification, holding him to a standard of truth beyond the strength of human flesh. Why else should all these great people take up their time with him? He was nobody, nothing to them. He could not bring himself to answer, not here in front of everyone, in front of her. She might be the agent of God's truth, but he thought no woman had ever appeared more as if she'd been sent by the arch-fiend to enthrall a man. The silence lengthened, condemning him. He looked at her and at Isabel's open, tear-streaked face. His wife stared back at him. Ruck closed his eyes. He shook his head. No.
"Sire Roderick," the Archbishop said heavily, "with this admission of impurity and other considerations, the vow given to your wife must be considered invalid."
As the interpreter translated, Isabel broke into a great wail.
"Silence!"
the Archbishop thundered, and even Isabel drew in her breath in shock at the suddenness of it. In the pause, he said,
"You must be heard by your confessor, Sire Roderick. I leave your penance to him. For the other matter—"
he glanced at Isabel, who had crawled forward and lay tugging at his hem.
"In the usual course, one spouse is prevented from taking such a vow of chastity if the other does not consent to it and vow also the same. Consent alone is not sufficient, as without the consolation of a solemn commitment to live celibate and close to God, the temptations of the flesh may prove too great."
He looked at Ruck.
"Lacking this true commitment, you will see the wisdom in such requirement, Sire Roderick."
Ruck could barely hold the man's eyes. He nodded slightly, burning all over. The Archbishop lifted his hand.
"Nevertheless, this woman appears to me to be a special case. With the proper provisions, I am willing to allow that she may be attached to the convent and live in obedience to the rules of the house without her husband's concurrent vow. After I have examined her further in the articles of the faith and found her response to be satisfactory, and the provision for her support has been received, she may be admitted to the order."
When Isabel heard the translation of this, she kissed the Archbishop's hem and showed clear signs of working herself into an ecstasy. The Archbishop made a gesture of dismissal. Ruck found himself escorted toward the door. He wrenched his arm from the clerk's hold and turned back, but people had crowded in. From the corridor, all he saw was the Lady of the Falcon, lifting her hand to her ear with a look of pained sufferance as Isabel's voice rose to a shriek. The door closed. A clerk accosted him, informing him that an endowment of 37 gold florins had been promised on behalf of Isabel and would be accepted at once. 37 gold florins was all the money that Ruck had, the last of the ransom from the two French knights he'd captured at Poitiers. The clerk took it, counting carefully, biting each coin before he dropped it into the holy purse. Ruck walked to the hostel as if in a dream. His steps took him first to the stable, to make certain at least of his horse and his sword, when everything else seemed a daze.
"Already gone," the hostler said.
The haze vanished. Ruck grabbed him by the throat, sending his broom flying.
"I paid thee, by God!"
He threw the man against the wall.
"Where are they?" "The priest!"
The hostler scooted hastily out of reach.
"The priest came to collect them, gentle sire.
Your good wife? He stumbled to his feet, ducking. Is not she to go for a nun? He had a bishop's seal, an offering to the church on her behalf, he said. He told me you had willed it so. A bishop's seal, my lord! I'd not have let them go for less on my life!
Ruck felt like a man hit by a poleaxe, still on his feet but reeling.
They took my horse, he asked numbly. My lord's arms, too!
From a safe distance, the hostler made a sympathetic grunt.
They would fain have me climb upstairs after your mail and helm. Bloodsuckers, the lot of them!
Isabel had made him leave his armour. She had made a great ado of it. 37 gold florins. Exactly what she had known was in his purse. And his horse. His sword. His armour. He locked his hands over his head and tilted his face to the sky. A howl burst from him, a long bellow that reverberated from the stones like a beast's dumb roar. Impotent tears and fury blurred his vision. He leaned back against the wall and slid down it, sitting in the dirt with his head in his arms.
"You might sue for to have the horse back, if it were a mistake, gentle sire," the hostler offered kindly.
Ruck gave a miserable laugh from the hollow of his arms.
"How long would that take?" "Ah, who could know? 20 year, mayhap." "Yea, and cost the price of 12 horse," he muttered.
"True enough," the hostler agreed morbidly. Ruck sat curled, staring into the darkness of his arms, his back against the stone wall. He heard the hostler go away, heard people talking and passing. Grief and rage spun him. He couldn't move. He had nowhere to go, no wife, no money, nothing. He couldn't seem to get his mind around the full dimension of it. A smart prod at his shoulder pushed him half off his balance. He looked up, with no notion of what time had passed except that the shadows lay longer and deeper on the street. The prod came again, and Ruck grabbed at the staff with an angry oath. Before him stood the hunchbacked mute he'd gifted with a denier, and his first thought was that he wished that he had the money back again. The beggar held out a little pouch. Ruck scowled. The hunchback wriggled the pouch and offered it closer. He waited, staring at Ruck expectantly as he accepted it. The bag contained a folded paper and a small coin. The beggar was still waiting. Ruck held onto the coin for a moment, but futile pride overcame him, and he tossed it to the beggar with no good grace. The man grinned and saluted, shuffling away. Ruck watched his dinner and bed disappear up the narrow street. He unfolded the paper and jerked, catching at the green glitter that fell from inside.
"I charge thee, get thee far hence ere night falleth. Fail not in this."
He gazed at the English words and the 2 emeralds in his palm. One was small, no bigger than the lens of a dragonfly. The other was of a size to buy full armour and mount and pay a squire for 1 year. A size to adorn a falcon's arrogant crest. He held the emeralds, watched them wink and catch the light. He knew what he ought to do. A good man, a virtuous man, would stand up and stride to the palace and throw them in her face. A godly man would not let himself be bound to such a one as she. He'd given up his wife to God, and his horse, and his armour, and his money. Ruck closed his hands on the jewels she sent, and swore himself to the archfiend's daughter.
Ayere yernes fulierne, and yeldes never licke, the former to the finishment foldes full selden. Forther this yule or yede, and a yere after, and each a season ser lepes sued after other. And thus yernes be yere in yesterdayes moni, and winter windes ayen. A year turns full turn, and yields never like, the first to the finish conform full seldom, for by this yule over, and the year after, and each season separately ensued after other. And thus yields the year in yesterday's many, and winter wends again. Sir Gawain and the Green Knight.
1.
Year's gifts!
The cry rose with squeals and laughter as the ladies of Bordeaux craned, reaching for the prizes held tauntingly overhead by their gay tormentors. Veils came askew, belts failed, and sent misericords flying in the tussle. In a rush of varicolored silks and furs, each gentleman went down in willing defeat, yielding his New Year's keepsake for the price of a kiss. The first great pestilence was 22 years gone, the second scourge 10 Christmases past. But though the French harried Aquitaine's borders and yet another outbreak of the dread black swellings had killed Lancaster's White Duchess herself just last year, such dire thoughts were blown to oblivion when the trumpets gave forth a great shout, sounding the arrival of pastries to the hall, fantastic shapes of ships and castles, and a stag that bled claret wine when the gilt arrow was plucked from its side. A mischievous lady was the first to toss an eggshell full of sweet water at her lord. The carved rafters resounded with glee, and in a moment every man was wiping perfumed drops from his lashes, grinning, demanding another kiss for his misfortune. Some hungry lordling broke the crust of a huge pie, and a dozen frogs leapt free, thumping onto the table amid skips and feminine screams. From another pie came a rush of feathered bodies, birds that flew to the light, and put out the candles as the company filled the gloom with shrill enjoyment. The Duke of Lancaster himself sat with languid elegance at the high table of Ombrière, watching critically as kettledrums and the wild high notes of warbling flutes heralded the first course. At the Duke's right hand, his most high and honoured guest, the Princess Melanthe de Monteverde, overlooked the dim, noisy hall with cold indifference. Her white falcon, equally impassive, gripped its carved and painted block with talons dipped in silver. The bannered trumpets sounded once more. All the candles and torches glowed again in magical unison, illuminating the hall and dais as the liveried servants held the lights aloft. Lancaster smiled, leaning very near Princess Melanthe.
"My lady's highness likes not mirth and marvels?"
She gave him a cool glance.
"Marvels?" she murmured in a bored tone. "I expect naught less than a unicorn before the sweetmeats."
Lancaster grinned, allowing his shoulder to touch hers as he reached to refill the wine cup they shared.
"Too commonplace. Nay, give us a more difficult task, princess."
Melanthe hid her annoyance. Lancaster was courting her. He would not be snubbed, and he would not be forestalled. He took her coldness as challenge, her reluctance as mere dalliance.
"Then, sir, I will have it green,"
she said smoothly, and to her vexation he laughed aloud.
"Green it shall be."
He signalled to an attendant and leaned back to speak in the servant's ear, then gave Melanthe a sidelong smile.
"Before sweetmeats, my lady, a green unicorn."
The heavy red and blue cloth of his sleeve brushed her arm as he lifted the cup toward her lips, but the bishop on his other side sought him. In his distraction, Melanthe took her opportunity to capture the goblet from his hand. She could already see the assembly's reaction to his attentions. Swift as metheglin could intoxicate a man, another horrified report began to spread among the tables below. It would be a subdued mumble, Melanthe knew, passed over a shared sliver of meat or a fingerful of sweet jelly, whispered under laughter with the true discretion of fear. Lancaster was 30, handsome, and vigorous in the full strength of manhood. While his oldest brother, the Black Prince, lay swollen and confined to his bed with dropsy, it was Lancaster who kept court as Lieutenant of Aquitaine. But who could blame a younger son of the King of England, most surely one of such energy and pride as Lancaster, if his ambitions were for greater things than service to his brother? Everyone knew he would take another high-born heiress after losing his good Duchess Blanche, and no one expected him to dally long about it. But Mary, Mother of God, even for the gain it would bring him, did he truly contemplate the Princess Melanthe? She could almost hear the whispers as she sat next to him upon the dais and surveyed the company. There, that woman in the blue houppelande, leaning back to speak to the next table. She was no doubt complaining to her neighbour that such a gerfalcon as Princess Melanthe carried
was too great for a woman to fly. Nothing in the Duke's mews could match it. Not even the Black Prince himself owned such a bird. The insolence that she would display it so at the Duke's own feast. Immodesty. Wicked vanity and arrogance. Melanthe gave the woman a long, dispassionate stare, and had the pleasure of watching her victim turn white with dismay at the attention. Her reputation preceded her. And those three, the two knights inclining so near to the pretty fair-haired girl between them, Melanthe could see the relish in their faces. Widowed of her Italian prince, the men would say, heiress to all her father's vast English lands. And the girl would whisper that Princess Melanthe had caused a maiden to be drowned in her bath for dropping a cake of Castile soap. From her late husband, someone else would murmur, the income of an Italian city-state. From her English father, Lord of Boland, holdings as large as Lancaster's, she'd taken 15 lovers and murdered all of them. For a man to smile at her was certain death. Here the knights would smirk and grin. Certain, but exquisite. The final price for the paradise he could savour for as long as it pleased her to dally with him. Melanthe had heard it all, knew what they spoke as well as if she sat among them. But still, Lancaster paid her court with polish and wolf's glances, smiles and covetous stares, barely concerned to keep his desire in check. Melanthe knew what they were saying of that, too. She had entrapped him, ensorcelled him. He'd left off his black mourning. All trace of lingering grief for his beloved Blanche had vanished. He looked at the Princess Melanthe as he looked at her falcon, with the look of a man who has determined what he will have, and damn the price. She only wished she might ensorcel him, and turn him to a toad. Tonight she must act. This public gallantry of his could not be allowed to go on without check. Before the banquet ended, she must spurn him so that he and no one else could doubt it. When she looked out upon the trestles, she saw the assassin who watched her, tame and plump in her own green and silver livery, but in truth, another spawn of the Riata family, one of the secret wardens set upon her. Only by the mastery of long practice did she maintain her cold serenity against the hard beat of her heart. The food arrived with full pomp and glitter, loaded onto cloths of purest linen, the procession winding endlessly among the tables. Lancaster offered her the choice dainties from his own fingers. She brought herself to the point of rudeness in response to him. By God's self, must he be so open about it, this determined public pursuit in the face of her expressed displeasure, when he might have had the sense to send his envoy by night and secrecy to measure her willingness? But he thought it agreeable sport, she saw, a lover's game of disinterest and affectation. He full expected that she would have him. She had told him more than once that she would have no man, but none here would blame him for his confidence. It was a brilliant match. Their lands marched together in the north of England. The sum of their possessions would rival the king's. By this alliance, the Duke could make her the greatest lady in Britain, and she could make him greater yet than that. It was not passion alone that drove him to these smiles and hot looks. She touched him lightly, when he leaned too close, to remind him that they were in the court's view. He grinned, sitting back in obedience, but a moment later he had leaned near again, grasping her hand possessively, holding it in his upon the table in a gesture as clear as a proclamation. The Riata stood up from his seat, mingling with the servants as they passed up and down the hall. Melanthe made no move to disengage herself. It was a game of hints and inklings between her and the Riata's man, a language of act and counteract. He moved closer, warning her, reminding her of her agreement with Riata, and her peril if she thought to wed any man, especially such a one as Lancaster. She merely looked at the Duke's fingers entwined with hers on the white cloth, refusing to show fear. Her heart was beating too hard, but she held to her aloof composure, asking Lancaster for a loaf of trimmed pandemain from the golden platter just set down before them, so that he must let go her hand to serve her properly. When she looked up, She saw the Riata lingered in a closer place, even though the Duke had released her. Verily, Lancaster's hopes must be crushed, or she would be fortunate to see the light of another morning. Gringalet moved uneasily on her perch at Melanthe's elbow, the falcon's silver bells ringing as she half-roused to the sweeping flutter of a sparrow that still flew, panicked among the roof-beams. Noble stewards clustered and moved behind and before the dais, attending the Duke and his guests, trimming bread, carving quail, knives and poison and colour. She could not keep them all in her eye at once, as adept as she had made herself at such things. The Riata could kill her as well before the entire hall as in some dark passage. It was too dangerous and open a position. She had not chosen it. She had tried to avoid it. But Lancaster's ambitions had overwhelmed her subtleties. She must sit at his high table and deny him to his face. She had misjudged. These reckless English. She saw that she had been too accustomed to the feints and lethal shadows of the Italian courts to recall the power of plain English boldness. She would be fortunate to find her way to her chambers alive in this castle of unfamiliar corners and hidden places. An ill luck it had been that had brought her to Bordeaux at all on her way home to England. She'd foreseen this disaster with Lancaster well enough to avoid the place by intention, but still had not cared to chance her French welcome and take the most northern route. She'd skirted Bordeaux, choosing the road to Limoges, only to meet there the English army just done with razing the town to ashes. Lancaster wielded his courtesy with the same skill he handled a sword. She must not rush on her way home to Boland, he had insisted graciously. There was to be a New Year's tournament. She must come to Bordeaux and honour him with her presence at the celebration. He had the ear of his father the king, he told her with his elegant, hungry smile. He would write his recommendation that Princess Melanthe be put in possession of her English inheritance immediately and without prejudice. That he might, if he chose, equally well jeopardise her prospects with King Edward, needed no such blunt hinting. Wherefore, she was here. And Lancaster continued on his fatal determination, courting her through the service of the white meats and the red. She lost sight of the Riata, and then found him again, closer. The moment approached. Lancaster would ask for her favour to carry in the tournament tomorrow. He had already told her that he would fight within the lists. In this public place, hanged be the man, Lancaster would beg her for a certain token of her regard, and force her to a public answer. There was no eluding it, no hope that he would not. His intention toward her was in his every compliment and sidelong glance. She had thought of becoming faint and retiring, but that could only put the thing off until the morrow, another night on guard against the Riata, and set off a round of further solicitude from the Duke. Beyond that, the Princess Melanthe did not become faint. It was a weakness. Melanthe did not choose to show weakness. She would end with Lancaster a powerful enemy, his lands marching with hers in bitterness instead of friendship. A man such as he would not soon forget a woman's public refusal. Among these northerners, chivalry and honour counted for all, but the Riata must be shown that she would not have the Duke, and must be shown it soon and well. She suffered Lancaster's attentions to grow more and more direct. She began to encourage him, though he needed no encouragement from her to lead himself to his own humiliation. She was angry at him, but smiled. She regretted him, but she smiled still, ruthless, laughing at his wit, complimenting his banquet. It was no sweet love that drove Lancaster now, but ambition and a man's lust. She could not save him if he would not save himself. The second course arrived. As a gilded swan was carved before them, the Duke grew a little drunk with wine and success. He plucked a subtlety in the shape of a rosebud from the profusion of decoration on the platter, and offered it to her with a glance more of affection than desire. Melanthe accepted the almond sweet from his fingers. She looked at him, smiling softly upon her, and felt a twinge of regret for his spare, comely figure, for women's fancies, things she had heard about him, of the love he bore still for his first wife,
things that could not now nor ever be between her and a man. In exchange for her life, his pride. It seemed a fair enough bargain to Melanthe. As Lancaster prepared their shared trencher with his own hands, she glimpsed a slim figure in blue and yellow hose in the throng below. Allegretto Navona lounged at the edge of the hall, near the great hearth, his black hair and bright hues almost blending into the shapes and figures in the huge tapestry on the wall behind him. The youth was looking toward the dais. As Melanthe accepted the Duke's tidbit, Allegretto smiled directly at her. It was his sweet smirk, charming and sly. She stared at him a moment. He had succeeded at something. She looked again quickly for the assassin wearing her own green and silver livery. There he was, the one Reata watchdog she knew of certainly, still holding checked, still only observing from a distance. Allegretto had not slain or expelled him, which did not mean that the youth had not bloodied his hands in some other way. She was torn between anger and relief. She had her own agreement with the Reata. In spite of the unceasing threat of the watchers they had placed on her, she wanted no Reata lives spent. Not now. But she could not disclose that to a son of the House of Navona. And a murder in the midst of this banquet, in her retinue, it would be offensive. There would be trouble. Things were not done so here as they were in Italy, but she could not make Allegretto understand. She did not acknowledge him with more than a brief look, reserving her pleasure. He made a face of mock disappointment, then lifted his chin in silent mirth. A pair of servants bore huge platters past him. When they had moved beyond, he was gone. The trumpets sounded. Melanthe looked up in startlement. They could not yet herald the last course. Over the hum of gossip and feasting came the shouts of men outside the hall. Her hand dropped instinctively to her dagger as the clatter of iron hooves rang against the walls. People gasped. Servers scattered out of the great entry doors, spilling platters of sweets and more subtleties. Melanthe reached for Gringolet's leash. An apparition burst into the hall. A green-armored knight, on a green horse, hurtled the stairs, galloping up the center aisle, the ring of hooves suddenly muffled by the woven rushes, so that the pair seemed to fly above the earth as ladies screamed and dogs scrambled beneath the tables. Nothing hampered his drive to the high dais. Not a single knight rose to his lord's defense. Melanthe found herself on her feet alone, gripping her small dagger as Gringolet roused her feathers and spread her wings in wild alarm. The horse reached the dais and whirled, half-rearing, showing emerald hooves and green legs, the twisting silver horn on its forehead slashing upward. The destrier's braided mane flew out like dyed silk as light sent green reflections from the lustrous armor. Silver bells chimed and jangled from the bridle and caparisons. At the peak of the knight's closed helm flourished a crest of verdant feathers, bound by silver at the base, set with an emerald that sent one bright green flash into her eyes before he brought the horse to a standstill. The knight was on a level with her, the eye slits in his visor dark with the daunting inhumanity that was the life and power of his kind. The destrier's heavy breath seemed to belong to both of them. He held the reins with gloves of green worked in silver. On his shield, the only emblem was a hooded hawk, silver on green. Rich ermine lined his mantle, and all over the horse's caparisons, embroidered dragonflies mingled with flowers and birds, silver only, argent and green entire. Melanthe's hand relaxed slightly on the dagger as she realized that this was not immediate attack. She felt the sudden exposure of standing alone, but it was too late to sit down and hide her reaction. Everyone stared, and after their first startlement, no one appeared dismayed. At the edge of her vision, she could see the Duke grinning. "My lady," Lancaster said into the utter stillness, "your unicorn comes." "Mary," Melanthe said, "so it does."
"My liege lady."
The knight's voice sounded hollow and harsh from within the helmet. He made a bow in the saddle. The horse danced.
My dread lord.
Trusty and well-beloved knight. The Duke acknowledged him with a lazy nod.
My lady, we call him the Green Sire who rides your unicorn. I fear he will not grace us with his true name.
Liege lord of my life, the knight said. I have made a vow.
Yea, I remember. Not until thou art proved worthy, was it? At least remove thy helm, sir. It alarms the ladies, as thou canst well see.
He made a slight gesture toward Melanthe. The green knight hesitated. Then he seized his helmet and pulled it off his head. The feathers fluttered as he held it under his arm. Melanthe glanced at the emerald that adorned the crest and looked into his face. But he kept his eyes well cast down, focused on some spot below the table at Lancaster's feet, showing mostly a head of black hair cut short and unruly. He was clean-shaven, with a strong jaw and strong features, sun and battle-hardened in a way that was different from the men she was accustomed to, in the way of campaign and chevauchée, open-air knight-errantry, instead of close-handed duellum with wits and dagger. Melanthe had an abiding respect for any type of violence. This type had the benefit of a certain novelty. One could appreciate the theory of chivalrous knighthood. One could smile at the idea of a man who would not give his name until he was proven worthy. Since she felt the urge to smile, she followed the primary rule of her existence and did not do it. Had she followed that principle a moment ago, stifling instinct, she would not now be standing in this foolish and conspicuous way, showing herself the only one who had been so affected by the sensational entrance.
"You desire a unicorn, and I give it you," Lancaster said in high good humour. "The beast is yours to command, princess."
The knight lifted his head slightly. His face was immobile. A faint tickle of significance stirred in Melanthe's mind, a fleeting thought she could not catch. He was indeed a fine man, tall on his horse, strong of limb, his face that combination of beauty and roughness that provoked the ladies to sighs and the more elegant courtiers to spiteful remarks about vulgarity. The range of expression in the company behind him was of vast interest to Melanthe, and not least intriguing, the Green Knight's own taut countenance. He had a look of extremity on him, some emotion far more intense than mere play-acting at marvels before a lady.
"What will you, my lady?" Lancaster asked. "Shall you send them to hunt dragons?"
The knight glanced at Melanthe for an instant, then away, as if the contact startled. His destrier shifted restlessly beneath him, its enameled hooves thumping on the braided rush. The bells jangled. With an abrupt move, he yanked one glove from his hand and threw it down before the company.
"A challenge!" he shouted.
He turned about in the saddle, scanning the hall, rising in his stirrups.
"For the honor of my lady, tomorrow I take all who come."
Lancaster went stiff beside her. He stood up.
"Nay, sir," he snapped, "such is not thy place to defend her highness."
The knight ignored his liege.
"Is this the court of the Black Prince and Lancaster?"
he shouted furiously.
"Who will fight me for the honour of my lady?"
His voice echoed in the stunned silence of the hall. They stared at him as if he had lost his senses. But comprehension burst upon Melanthe. This was the source of Allegretto's mirthful satisfaction. He had created a chance for her.
"Cease thy nonsense," Lancaster growled in a low voice. "It does thee no credit, sir."
The Green Knight had dropped his veneer of submissive respect. His gaze hit Melanthe and skewed away again. He dismounted and went down on his knee before her in a chinking clash of mail.
"My lady."
Over the edge of the table, she could see that he held his bare hand against his heart, the plumed helmet thrust under his arm.
"I crave of you, do me this ease. Give me something of your gift, that I might carry the precious prize tomorrow, and defend against all comers."
"Thou shalt not do so,"
the Duke declared, his voice rising.
"I carry her highness's favour, impudent rogue!"
Melanthe seized her moment. She slanted him a cool look.
"Think you so, my lord?" she asked softly.
Lancaster glanced at her, his face growing red.
"I..."
His jaw went taut.
"I am at your service, if you will honour me," he said stiffly.
Melanthe smiled at him. She caught Gringalet's jesses and pulled the soft white calf's leather loose from about the falcon's legs, slipping her dagger inside to cut the bailed buets and the jesses free. Gringalet's varvels swung suspended from the ends, two silver rings jewelled with emeralds and diamonds, and engraved with Melanthe's name. She slipped the bells from Milan onto the jesses, tying them so that they made a falcon's music, one note striking high and one low, in the rich harmony that belonged to nothing else in heaven or earth. Lancaster was watching her. She looked at him for a long, significant moment, then turned back to the knight, who still knelt below her.
"Green sire," she declared, "the most precious prize I possess on earth, I give thee for a keepsake, to defend me for my honour on the morrow."
She tossed the jesses with their gems and bells onto the rush before him.
"I challenge for it," Lancaster exclaimed instantly. "And I, on my lord's behalf."
A man stood up beyond him on the dais.
"And I."
They were seconded by two more, and then four, knights standing in the hall to shout their dares until the hammer beams rang.
"Enough!"
Lancaster lifted his arm.
"It shall be arranged who will fight."
He glared down at the green knight.
"Rise then, insolent fellow."
The knight came to his feet, his eyes downcast again. She noticed that he'd had the presence of mind to retrieve his gauntlet, along with the jesses, while he knelt. Not entirely a lackwit. God only knew how Allegretto had threatened or enticed him to do this thing. The knight stood waiting with a stony stare at his lord's feet, the light on his virid armour sculpting broad curves at his shoulders, chasing silver arcs across his arm plates. Lancaster could barely keep the fury from his face.
"A most marvellous unicorn," she said with amusement. "My lord's grace is kind to put him at my service."
Lancaster seemed to find some control of his emotion. He bowed to her, producing a smile that did not quite cover the grim set of his jaw.
"I would have counted it worth my life to serve you myself, my lady. But now I count it an honour to win your better regard by trial tomorrow, against this man I had thought under true oath to me."
The Green Knight looked up, his expression a fascinating play of yearning and pride, of checked temper.
"My beloved lord, I wish with my whole heart to please you, but my lady commands me."
"Thou takest too much credit upon thyself, knave."
The knight glanced to Melanthe, his eyes as green as his armour, human now instead of hidden by steel and darkness. In his intense gaze, there was an open dismay of his own defiance before his prince. He looked to her, hoping for reprieve, asking her for release from what he had done. She held him, denying it. Her answer was unrelenting silence. The knight bowed his head. She could see the taut muscle in his bared neck.
"Does my lord bid me serve his pleasure before my lady's?"
he asked in a low voice. It was a futile attempt, hardly more than a strained whisper. Without an appeal from Melanthe herself, Lancaster would not withdraw, could not now, when he had agreed to fight.
"I do not well know where thou comest by this notion that Her Highness stoops to command such as thee," Lancaster snapped.
"From me, mayhap?" Melanthe murmured.
The Duke gave her a sullen small bow.
"Then your wish is mine," he said curtly, "and my command, of course. This man shall ride for you on the morrow, my lady, against myself and all who challenge for your favour."
The Green Knight lifted chagrined eyes to Melanthe. Holding Gringalet on her wrist, ignoring Lancaster, she gave her new champion a small smile and dropped a mocking bow of courtesy.
"I look forward to such spectacle. Go now and refresh thyself, green sire. Attend me in chamber when dinner is done."
"May God reward you, lady,"
he murmured mechanically, and stood. With an easy move that belied the weight of his armour, he remounted, reining the horse around and spurring it to a gallop. He parted the men-at-arms at the door, vanishing out of the hall with an echo of hooves and bells. Of course she didn't remember him. Ruck tore the loaf of white bread and shed more crumbs onto his bare chest, causing mute Pierre to gesture and dust him urgently. But there was no time to sit down for a meal, as his broken-backed squire wished. His lady, his liege lady, the cherished queen of his heart, commanded him immediately after the dinner, and by the time he'd stabled Hawk, secured his mount's armour and his own, harried Pierre, and sufficiently bullied and bribed the fourth chamberlain for a bath in the midst of a banquet, he could hear the higher note of the trumpets that signified the lord's retirement from the hall. A light-headed sickness hung in his throat. The dry bread seemed to choke him. It was almost too fantastical to believe that it was her, that she was here. He had never expected it. He hardly knew how to fathom the fact, or what he had just done for her. Christ, Lancaster's face. But Ruck could not bear to think of it.
Hi!
He knocked Pierre's hand aside as the squire tried to wipe the shaving soap from him. The barber had been impossible to obtain at such a time.
My hose!
He grabbed the towel, cleaned his jaw himself, and finished off the bread before Pierre had the green hose ready for him. He didn't think she remembered him. He couldn't settle it in his mind. By her young courtier in the yellow and blue motley, she had sent him a command to challenge for her. She had looked upon him in the hall with that cool authority, as if she knew his vow to her service, as if she expected it. He had a wild thought that she had known all there was to know of him since that day he had first seen her, that his every move for 10 and 3 years had somehow been open to her. Those eyes of hers, for God. She was here, and in faith it felt more like a blow to his belly than a boon. His breath frosted in the cold as he bit into an apple. Holding the fruit between his teeth, he pulled the green hose over his linen. A few gentlemen began to wander out of the great hall to relieve themselves, passing the open door of the buttery, where the servants had grudgingly hauled the bathtub for Ruck.
La la! Seest thou, Christine? Said a feminine voice. He is not green all over.
Ruck looked up from belting his hose to find a pair of ladies leaning in the door. He did not know either of them. He dropped the apple from his mouth and caught it in one hand. As he bowed, he grabbed his mantle from Pierre's hands and tossed it around his bare shoulders.
A common man only, madam.
The dark-haired one giggled. The other, the one who'd spoken, was blonde and comely, and she knew it. She moved upon him with a flow of brilliant parti-colour robes.
Thy form gives thee the lie, sir. Thou art uncommon strong and pleasing.
Smiling, she traced him with her forefinger from the base of his throat down to his chest.
And uncommon brave to proclaim such a challenge.
He lightly clasped her hand and lifted it away from him.
For the honour of Her Highness, he said evenly.
Her smile deepened.
Such wild courage, she murmured, lifting her mouth. We have heard much of your ferocity in battle. Stay and tell us more.
He looked down at her offered lips, the soft, smiling curve.
For God's mercy, you tempt me to dally, but I cannot.
He held up the apple, brushed her cheek with the rosy, smooth skin, and pressed the fruit into her fingers, setting her away from him.
Accept this, and I know I've shared a suite with a gracious lady.
A shadow of pique crossed her features, but she stepped back, taking a bite with a crunch of white teeth.
The Princess Melanthe, she said airily. You know her?
I know her, he said.
Ah, then you know to accept no apples of love from that one. She poisoned her own husband.
Ruck stiffened.
Madam, it were better that thou spake truth on thy tongue.
Oh, I speak true enough.
She licked a drop of juice from the apple.
Ask it of anyone. She was put to trial for the deed.
He scowled at her for a moment, and then held out his hand to Pierre for his tunic. His squire caught the mantle as Ruck shrugged it off, and pulled the green wool over his head. A few more gentlewomen hovered outside.
"She is a sorceress," his blonde temptress said, and looked to the others. "Is she not?"
"That gerfalcon," another offered. "The bird is her familiar. Never has she flown it in the light of day. She bewitched the magistrate to release her. She took her own brother for a lover.
Yea, and murdered him with that very dagger at her waist, whilst he was a guest in her husband's house, and now on her way to gorge on his birthright. But no Christian knight will escort her hence, for fear of his soul."
"Nay," Ruck objected. "She's a princess."
"A witch, Sir John will say you."
Feminine hands urged a knight forward from where he'd been lingering at the edge of the group, trying to woo one of the gentlewomen. Pierre helped Ruck into his surcoat, smoothing down the cloth of silver. Ruck stood facing the other man, his jaw rigid.
"Have a care," he said. "The chatter of the women is naught. On behalf of my sworn lady, sir, I will not take thy word so lightly."
"You have sworn to her?" the blonde asked, stepping back.
"Yea, I am her man."
"For the tourney," the other knight said. "My lord the Duke will abide no more."
He gave Ruck a shrewd grin.
"It was a bold stroke you took. He's angry now, but he'll value you to show him at his finest on the morrow."
"I am her man," Ruck repeated.
Sir John looked at him.
"Nay, you don't mean to be serious in this?"
Ruck stared back, eyes level, showing nothing.
"I am sworn to her. I am honored with her gift. I fight for the Princess Melanthe."
The spectators began to depart, withdrawing with sidelong glances and murmurs among them. Ruck threw his mantle round his shoulders and stabbed the pin of his silver brooch through the cloth. When he looked up, he and Pierre were alone in the buttery. The mute squire elevated his eyebrows expressively. He dug in his apron and held out a leather-bagged amulet.
"She is not a witch," Ruck snapped.
Pierre crossed himself and mimicked a priest blessing the charm.
"Curse thee! She's my lady!"
Pierre ducked and genuflected. With a roll of his eyes and a shake of his head, he tucked his saint's tooth away.
2.
"Tell me," Melanthe said lightly in Italian, "I can see that you're full of your own shrewdness."
Allegretto Navona rested against the curve of the spiraling stairwell, his arms crossed, grinning down at her from 2 steps above. The last thin light fell between them from an arrow slit.
"The green man is invincible, my lady," he whispered, leaning as near as he dared while she had Gringolet on her fist. "Your fine Duke of Lancaster will have his tail feathers plucked tomorrow."
"Will he? After they have sent half their knighthood against my poor champion?"
She made a short laugh.
"So I suppose I must title him."
"Nay, you miscalculate your knight, lady. They have another name for him here. They call him after some barbarian tale from the north, Berserker or some such."
He gave an elegant shudder.
"I'm told it is the north name of a savage in bear coats, a warrior who would as soon kill as breathe."
"Berserker,"
Melanthe said, gazing at Allegretto thoughtfully.
"You have busy ears to know so much of him. Where did you find this great warrior?"
"Why, in the stable, my lady, braiding his green destrier's green mane with silver, in preparation to fight in the Hastelude tomorrow. A most pure and courteous knight, well liked by common men-at-arms. He keeps to himself and the foot soldiers in the chapel, and has no traffic with ladies. But when they ordered him to play your unicorn because of his colour, I thought to take him aside, your highness, and tell him of your wishes."
"My wishes?"
She lifted her eyebrows.
"You wished to bestow your tournament favour on him, lady."
Allegretto smiled angelically.
"Did you not? But he would have none of it, I fear, until I walked with him past the hall. I caused him to look upon you, lady. And sweet Mary, I only wish you might have seen his face."
"What was in his face?" she asked sharply.
Allegretto leaned his head back against the curving wall.
"Indifference. And then," he paused, "but what does my lady's grace care of his thoughts? He is only an English barbarian."
She stroked Gringolet's breast. The gerfalcon's talons relaxed and tightened on the gauntlet. Allegretto did not change his lazy stance, but he moved a half step upward.
"Indifference, my lady," he said more respectfully, "until he had a fair sight of you, and then he became just such a witless lover as we needed to dissuade your duke, though he veiled it well."
"You promised him no promises," she said coldly.
"Lady, the sight of you is promise enough for a man," Allegretto murmured. "I made none, but I cannot vouch for what blissful hopes he might have in his own mind."
She regarded him for a long moment. He was young and beautiful, dark as a demon, and as sweetly formed as the devil could make him. Gringalet roused her feathers, pure, ruthless white. He glanced at the gerfalcon for the barest instant. Allegretto dreaded naught on earth but three things: the falcon, the plague, and his father. Gringalet was Melanthe's one true shield against him, for she had no mastery of the plague, and none over Gian Navona for a certainty. Prince Ligurio of Monteverde had been dead 3 months, but for years before he drew his last breath, Melanthe had upheld her husband's place and powers. As he declined into illness and vulnerability, she had defended him by the methods he had taught her himself. He it was who had schooled her to guard her back, who had been her father from the age of 12, when a terrified child had left England to wed a man 30 years her senior. He who had ordered her to deal with the Reata, to tantalize Gian Navona, because the triangle would always hold. There would always be the houses of Reata and Navona and Monteverde, like wolves prowling about the same quarry. Now Prince Ligurio was gone. The triangle of power fell in upon itself, leaving Melanthe between the wolves and the fortune of Monteverde. She relinquished it to them. She did not want Monteverde, but to yield her claim was as perilous as to contend for it. Like a fox making for a safe earth, she must dodge and deceive and look always behind her as she escaped. She had bargained with Reata, safe passage to a nunnery in England, in exchange for her quitclaim to Monteverde. She had bargained with Allegretto's father. She had smiled at Gian Navona and promised to be his wife, gladly, so gladly that she would even travel to England first to confirm her inheritance there, that she might bring that prize, too, with her to their marriage bed. Promise and promise and promise. They were made to betray, in layer upon layer of deception. She kept only one, if she died for it, to herself. She was going home, to England and to Boland. The fox escaped to earth.
"I am displeased with your interference," she said to Allegretto. "You do not understand the English. If you thought to discourage the Duke by such a challenge, it has done no more than place him so that he must prove his devotion, and now tomorrow I must spurn him yet again."
"I know aught of these boorish English manners, my lady," he said with light malice, "if a man must thrust his attention upon a lady without her encouragement."
"Save your indignation for a fool who meddles in his mistress's business. I had my own intent with regard to Lancaster."
Allegretto merely grinned at the rebuke.
"Not to take him in marriage, lady, so I hope. If he will not bring himself to the point and ask, I cannot take him, can I?"
"He will," Allegretto said. He made a mock bow.
"But my lady's grace would not break my father's loving heart that has bided so long in silent hope."
Melanthe returned his salute with an affectionate smile.
"I will not have Lancaster at any price. But Allegretto, my love, when next you write to your father, tell Gian that in truth you're such a tender, gentle boy. There are moments I should rather take you to husband in his stead."
Allegretto's face did not change. He maintained the pleasant curve of his lips, his dark eyes fathomless.
"I would not be so foolish, my lady. That price has indeed been paid already."
Melanthe turned her face. She shamed herself even to taunt Allegretto with it. What Gian Navona had taken of his bastard son to be certain that Allegretto would sleep chastely in Melanthe's bedchamber was beyond cost or pity.
"Let us go."
She lifted her skirt, stepping upward, but he made a faint hiss of warning and raised his forefinger. Instead of waiting for her to pass,
He turned, going lightly up ahead of her, his yellow and blue slippers silent on the stone stairs. Melanthe's pulse heightened. That was her weakness, as the falcon was Allegretto's. She could not for her life keep her heart cool when her mind required it. Through the harder beat in her ears, she turned to listen behind her.
"Come, give me a kiss, Allegretto," she said to the empty stairwell, "and let us be gone."
She heard nothing but the rhythm of her own blood. After a moment, she stepped up quietly after Allegretto, her hand on her dagger, her eyes on the turning of the newel. This winding stair gave onto the ramparts above and the chapel below, with a door into a small stone passage connecting to her inner apartment. She had not liked the insecure arrangement when she saw it, and she liked it less now. The door stood open to empty darkness. She hesitated, staring at it, assessing it. Gringalet preened calmly, but the falcon was no dog to bark at danger. She held aloof from human matters, as did all her kind. Melanthe took her misericord from its sheath and turned the blade outward. She lifted Gringalet, ready to fling the falcon safely free if she must.
"Come, lady."
Allegretto's ghostly voice drifted on silence, beckoning her. She took a quiet breath and stepped upward through the door. He knelt behind it over a deep shadow. Melanthe saw a white shape, a limp palm half open, and the shadow became a form. The Reata assassin sprawled dead in the half-darkness. There was no blood but on Allegretto's slim dagger. She had seen him practice his thrust on pigs to make a stab that stopped the life flow instantly. What little gore there was bled to the lungs and not the surface, as he had once informed her with his sweet pride and pleasure in his craft. He was not smiling now, but sober, skilled in his task, stripping the corpse of her livery. She pressed her lips tight together.
"To my garderobe," she murmured. "I'll send Kara and the others away."
He nodded. Melanthe moved quickly back down the stairs to the chapel whence she'd come, spent a moment pretending to pray, and then climbed to her apartments by the grand staircase. She retired to the solar, demanding a preparation of Malvoisie wine sweetened with scented flowers and roses, and peace for her aching head. Her ladies knew better than to be in a hurry to return when she gave such an order. When she was certainly alone, she unbolted the door onto the passage. Allegretto waited in the darkness, his prey stripped naked at his feet. He hefted the body to his shoulder, adept at that, too, though he staggered a little beneath the weight.
"Fat Reata swine," he muttered, and flashed Melanthe a grin over the pale legs of the dead man.
She stood back with an unforgiving stare, which made Allegretto laugh silently. Bravado, perhaps, or real amusement. It was no more possible to know his true feeling than it was for her to reveal the emotion that swirled in her stomach. She would punish him for this murder, because she had ordered him to refrain. But that did not diminish the horrible shock of triumph, the elation of safety, however brief, of knowing the thing done. He carried the body before her, naked arms dangling, a sight that she disliked. But worse yet was the garderobe, a cold small chamber and a cold stone bench, a revolting moment while Allegretto worked to arrange the Reata's flaccid torso, forcing it head downward into the shaft of the privy well, so that it would not wedge in the fall. He gripped it by the thighs, panting a little with his effort. The white, corpulent limbs scored against stone without bleeding, opposing him with slack resistance until he had shoved the thing in past the shoulders to the waist. He let go. The feet vanished. For a long moment, there was nothing. Then, the sound as it hit the river, not what she'd expected, not a splash, but a boom, like a stone catapulted against steel, echoing and echoing in the rank well. He crossed himself and knelt before her.
"I beg you pray for me, my lady," he said humbly. "I know I have displeased you, but I did it for your life."
She said nothing. He rose and caught up the pile of green and silver livery,
folding it into neat lengths. From the yellow shoulder of his doublet, he plucked a loose hair. He held it over the privy and flicked his fingers, sending the strand drifting into darkness. Melanthe watched him. She had no nightmares. She never slept enough to dream. The Princess Melanthe held audience amid Tharsia silks and exotic courtiers, warmed by a perfumed fire. And of course, she did not remember him. Ruck had himself not recognized her at once there in the hall, at a distance, chafed as he'd been by the Duke's sudden demand to appear in full tournament armor for the pleasure of some high-born lady, distracted by the strange foreign youth who dogged his heels. He'd thought nothing of the Duke's guests, annoyed by the whelp's insistence that Ruck pause at the door to look. He had seen only a bored and black-haired feminine figure on the dais, until she had turned her head and gazed with that cold irony upon Lancaster himself, had lifted her fingers to stroke the white falcon's breast. Not until that crystallized moment had her face and the silver and green colors that matched his own burst into recognition. Now that he saw her again, he could not imagine that he hadn't instantly perceived the lady of his life. She was precisely as he recalled. All of his dreams, all of his aspirations, 13 years of fidelity and devotion come to pass in gemstone radiance. Except that he had thought her hair not quite so dark, and her eyes a paler blue. In fact, he'd thought her more like Isabel, only comelier. She was comely indeed. Gloriously, magnificently beautiful. None could gainsay it, but in a bold style that made the lady's gossip just a trace more credible. Her chamberlain intoned, "The Green Sire, Your Highness." And she didn't even glance up at Ruck from the jewel casket that one of her gentlewomen held before her, merely lifting a hand toward the side of her bed. He strode to the position. The slender youth who had conveyed her command to Ruck, that he challenged for her favor, showed no such respect. The boy lounged against a carpet-covered chest, decked in hose of one leg yellow and one leg blue. From the extreme edge of his vision, Ruck could see the puppy staring at him. Keeping his eyes straight ahead, he had nothing to look at but his liege lady. And she was a vision like ebony hammered into gold. She had changed her gown. It was not now the low-cut kirtle of green samite that she had worn in the hall. It was a golden brocade cotardie, long-sleeved, tight-fitting, trimmed in black, cut open and laced all the way down both sides. And it took him a long moment to realize that she wore nothing beneath it. He could see her white, bared skin all the way from her torso to her ankle. He strove to keep his face expressionless. He dared not even blink. The sultry room made him hot beneath his ermine mantle. As she chose a necklace and belt of copper gilt and black enamel, the youth at his side moved, sliding a grin at Ruck, lolling across the bed to pluck the jewelry from her hands. She bent her head as he clasped the necklace at her nape and smoothed his fingers down her throat. He was 16, mayhap less, scarce half her age or Ruck's, with black hair and skin as soft as hers. He stroked her as a lover would, bending to fasten the belt about her waist, kissing her shoulder as he did it. She tilted her head, refusing to look into a mirror held up by one of the ladies. The youth watched Ruck beneath his lashes. "Let me take down your hair, lady," he said, moving to do it. His fingers worked amid the crown of braids, unpinning them, spreading them. He held a curling lock up to his lips, laughing silently through it at Ruck. "Look you, my love," he said, speaking clear while pretending to whisper in her ear. "The green man wants you."
"So much the worse for him," she said indifferently.
"Only look at him, lady." The youth was grinning in delight at Ruck. "He wishes that he might embrace you as I do. Just so." He slipped his fingers around her waist, never taking his black eyes from Ruck. She brushed his hands away.
"Come, leave thy mischief. Dost thou wish to sharpen thy claws on him, Allegretto? Play, then, but recall that he is of use to me. She turned for one instant and met the youth's eyes.
See that thou dost not kill him, or I shall set Gringalet upon thee.
This threat had a salutary effect upon her young courtier. He glanced at the falcon perched on a high stand at the foot of her bed.
Lady, he said submissively, drawing back from her. Do up my hair, she bid him. The crespin net, I think.
In silence he took the comb and sparkling net from her lady-in-waiting, and began to comb out the length of her hair, coiling it deftly. As he worked, Princess Melanthe lifted her hand, beckoning to Ruck. He moved to the foot of the bed, lowering himself to one knee. She laughed.
Truly thou art the most courteous knight. Up with thee. I prefer to see the faces of my servants better than the tops of their heads.
He stood up.
I will lead thy destrier into the lists tomorrow, she informed him. See that the heralds know it, and thou must wear my favour upon thy lance for the entry. Then I wish it brought to me for the nonce.
He bowed.
Thou speakest English, she said suddenly.
Yea, madam.
Excellent. I will from time to time speak to thee in English. I wish to recall it from my childhood. A lesson for thee, Allegretto. Always have a care to understand a little of the language of thy servants and dependents, that they may not take undue advantage of thee.
Allegretto pinned her hair, placing the net over it with care. In a subdued tone he said,
You are the source of all light and wisdom, Your Highness. Sweet boy, I would not let Gringalet have thee for aught.
The shadow left his face. He began to knead her shoulders. Ruck lowered his eyes to the foot of the bed. He took a step back, withdrawing.
Green sire, she said imperiously, rejecting the youth's attention with an impatient flick of her wrist. Word has come to my ear that thou art merciless in combat and tourney.
Ruck stood silent. She looked at him full for the first time, scanned him from foot to chest to shoulders, in the manner a hostler might assess a horse. A very faint smile played at her lips as she looked into his eyes, holding him with blue-purple dusk and mystery.
Excellent, she murmured. Savagery amuses me. And what glorious feats of arms shall I expect to see executed for my favour?
That answer he'd considered long and well, knowing the number who were sure to challenge him.
10 courses with the lance, he said evenly. 5 with the axe, and 5 courses with the sword will be my offer to any knight who strikes my shield. What glory that it please God I may gain is my lady's.
Well for that, her smile took on a hint of humour. My public esteem always stands in some want of lustre.
The moment of self-mockery glittered in her eyes and vanished, lost in a graceful, lithe motion as she lay back upon the cushions, beckoning for the wine-cup held by one of her ladies. He wanted to look away, but it was impossible. The irony and obscurity and dark radiance of her held him. Lancaster commanded Ruck as his prince and liege, but if she thought of that, she gave no sign. She set Ruck square in the sorest dilemma a man could be placed, vassal and servant to opposing masters. Though not for war or any great thing did she command him to declare a challenge for her on his own prince, not that Ruck could tell. Yet he would serve. She was his sworn lady. Beyond doubt or motive, he would obey her. It was not his place to ask for reasons, even if she did not remember him. And she did not. When she looked at him so negligently, he was certain, almost certain, that she did not. 2 emeralds and 13 years. But emeralds must be naught to such as she, as he would have been naught so long ago, a ridiculous boy, no one and nothing. He wore the green jewel on his helmet. He carried her falcon on his shield. Why had she asked for him, if she did not remember? She bent her head to take a sip from the hammered goblet.
and then paused before she tasted it. She stared into the wine for a long moment, her lashes black against skin of down and rose. When she looked up, it was toward the little group of ladies-in-waiting beside her bed, an emotionless sweep that remarked each one of them. And Ruck saw each of them in turn respond with the stone-silent terror of cornered rabbits. She lowered her eyes to the goblet again, without drinking.
"Thou wilt be valiant in my name on the morrow, green sire," she murmured, glancing up at him over the rim.
He gave a slight nod.
"See that it is so."
With a gesture, she dismissed him. Ruck turned from the sight of Allegretto trifling with a ring on her finger. At the door, he stopped, looking back.
"Your Highness," he said quietly.
She glanced up, lifting her brows. He nodded toward Allegretto and spoke in English.
"Nay, such as that could not kill me."
"What did he say?"
the youth demanded instantly. "He was looking at me." Princess Melanthe turned.
"Why, he said that in his devotion to me, Allegretto, he could defeat any man. A most handy green knight, think thee not."
As the knight departed, Allegretto turned the amethyst over and over on her finger. He leaned near her shoulder, laying his head next to hers. Melanthe lifted the cup of wine to his mouth and said,
"Share with me."
He drew in a light breath, and she felt the barely perceptible withdrawal in his muscles.
"My lady," he murmured, "I prefer the sweetness of your lips."
She tilted her head back, allowing him to trace his mouth down her throat. With a languid move, she held out the cup of wine and lay full back on the pillows. Kara lifted it from her hand with a deep curtsy, smiling that soft smile of hers, serene as a painting of the Virgin Mary. Though Melanthe closed her eyes, she could hear the light rustling and whispers as her gentlewomen retreated, well trained to recognize her inclinations. Allegretto put his mouth against her ear even before the ladies had quit the solar.
"Donna Kara," he said, "I told you to be rid of her. Send her away tonight."
Melanthe lay with her eyes closed. She bore his hands on her, her senses refined to catch the last instant that she must suffer his touch. The moment she could be certain they were alone, she flung his arm away and sat up.
"And I told you to kill no one. Tomorrow your back will feel the worse for it."
He hiked himself up to sprawl against the heap of pillows, impudent.
"Nay, lady, you know none of your men will touch me. They love my father too well." "Will please the Duke to lend me his guardsman for the task, I vow."
She left the bed and stood by the chest, gazing down into the goblet of scented wine. The candle beside it shuddered, reflecting a sinuous half-moon in the dark liquid.
"It is a warning."
"It can be aught else, Your Highness." He rolled to his side and lay propped on his elbow, only daunted enough to give her a deferential address.
"Bitter almond."
He drank a deep breath. "From here I can descry it." She gave a humorless smile.
"You're not so perceptive.
I could not detect it myself, but from within the cup." "It must have been Donna Kara. She sold herself to Riata and betrayed you. Mayhap no warning was meant, but a bungle. Stupid Monteverde bitch. She would blunder such work. Send her away, I tell you."
"Kara,"
Melanthe laughed, scorning that.
"Your mind is occupied past reason with the girl. By your notion, one moment she's subtle as a viper, and the next so stupid as to poison me with bane in my wine as if I could not smell it there."
"An idiot she is. Give her to me and I will teach her to be sorry for her treachery, so that she will not forget the lesson. She's not even worth the killing."
"Not worth killing? Why, Allegretto, you must be feeling unwell."
He grinned.
"Nay, only languishing in tedium. I should like to torment a Monteverde. It would make a change from these tiresome Riatas who die so easily."
Your malice masters your wit. Recall that she is my cousin.
He turned onto his back and crossed his leg, looking up at the canopy. My malice is bred in me, and Avona must hate anyone of Monteverdi.
He glanced toward her with a wry smile. Excepting you, my lady, of course.
Melanthe gazed again into the poisoned wine. She moved her head to bid him rise.
Take it to the garderobe. The cup will sink. I want no use of it again. Yea, my lady.
With youthful agility, he rolled to his feet and made a flourishing bow.
Ariata to hell, and a few fish to heaven. I call that a fine day's work for one garderobe.
Amid the call of herald's trumpets echoing high in the clear cold air, the Black Prince in his litter took the head of the procession, too ill to ride, barely able to attend at all, Melanthe had heard. She held her place among the ladies, carrying Gringalet in an emerald hood and a new set of bells and jesses, watching the chaos in the courtyard become order as the parade formed. The Duke had overcome his scowls. He held back, greeting Melanthe with every evidence of high good humour as he drew rein beside her palfrey.
Good morn, my lady!
He glittered in azure and scarlet, his shield emblazoned by the lions of England, quartered with the fleur-de-lis of France. At his side, a Moorish soldier with a white turban wrapped about his head walked a real lion on a leash of silk.
The day promises fine for our entertainments. A place of comfort is prepared for you upon the escafot, if you will honour us.
God grant you mercy for your kindness, she said. I shall come there when I will.
I pray it be soon, for my pleasure in your company.
When I will, she repeated mildly.
He bared his teeth in a grin.
I look forward with delight to that moment, madam, and to these contests.
Melanthe contained her palfrey's restless attempt to touch noses to his bay warhorse.
You're armed to take a part in the combat, my lord.
She nodded in approval.
Never yet have I seen a prince of the blood enter the lists. I commend your valour.
I shall break a lance or two, God willing. My lady's grace will recall that there is a challenge in her honour.
Melanthe smiled serenely.
I recall it.
Your champion is well renowned for his skill.
He shook his head, careless.
I shall attempt him, but I hold small hope of winning any prize in a joust with the celebrated Green Sire.
His casual tone was meant to give her surprise, she saw, for he looked at her with a glance that did not quite match his jocular indifference.
But my lord is his liege, are you not? She said. I am amazed that you undertake to meet him at all.
A short match only. A plaisance for your amusement. With blunted weapons he need not fear to fight his master.
He turned his horse, saluting her.
I shall open the jousts and return to your side as soon as I may, my dear princess.
With a swirl of bright colour, he circled and rode rapidly forward, his men and squires and even the lion running behind him to keep up. At the proper sedate pace, led by a young page, Melanthe's horse moved out at the head of the ladies, passing through the shadow of the gatehouse and the city streets. Townsfolk and spectators lined all the distance, shouting and running along beside the procession. Melanthe eyed them, wary of the high windows with their waving banners, the milling crowds, wary most of all of Cara and her other gentlewomen just behind her. She could not trust Allegretto's malicious counsel, but neither could she wholly trust Cara, as comely and credulous as her gentlewoman's dark eyes and soft, simple features might be. Any member of her retinue could succumb at any time to treachery or cajolery. The Reata were masters of both. The assassin's body had been pulled from the river this morning and hauled away to be buried nameless in a pauper's graveyard. Allegretto spent the day in the public stocks for his trouble, dragged bodily out of her bedchamber by Lancaster's men, a small instructive exercise that Melanthe had arranged for him. The murder had brought no more than a brief respite anyway, a moment's reprieve and then the poisoned wine to remind her. She was still watched by some creature of the Riata, and with a sharper threat, for now she did not know who it was. All she knew, certainly, was that they would see her dead before they saw her married again, carrying her rights with her to a man who would assert her claim to Monteverdi, such a one as Lancaster, ambitious and powerful, or worse for the Riata by a thousand times, Gian Navona. It was the imminent threat of Gian that Melanthe had used to bargain with them. She would not marry him, she swore. She would go home to England and enter a nunnery if they would allow her to leave unmolested. Once there, she would resign all right in Monteverde to the Riata, giving over her widow's perilous claim, and a further birthright descended 4 generations through her Monteverde mother. Too strong to defeat in a man's hand, too weak to prevail in a woman's. Beyond Allegretto's dagger, the yet unwritten quitclaim was all that preserved her life. It perfected the Riata's entitlement, giving them the advantage over Navona. The Riata wanted their paper precedence, but Melanthe was not fool enough to think they would not kill her and forego it if they suspected her treachery. The true house of Monteverde had already died with Ligurio. She had not given him an heir, only a black-haired daughter, and even that poor hope was lost, smothered in the nursery. He had done what he could to protect Melanthe. He had taught her what she knew, subtlety and corruption, Greek and Latin and astrology, charisma and cunning, strength. He had taught her the lion and the fox, the chameleon of all colours. All colours but white. Ligurio had trained her to trust no one and nothing, to lie of everything to everyone. And so, at the end, she had lied to him, too. He had died in the belief that she would take refuge in the Vale, retiring to the abbey he had founded in the hills of Tuscany, safe in a comfortable retreat with Monteverdi's lands and fortune rendered up to the Mother Church, invoking all the heavenly power and earthly greed of the men of God. She knew the bitter gall it had been to him to see his house die, but better passed to heaven than into the hands of his enemies. Her last gift to Ligurio had been her promise to do as he wished. Gift and lie. She had loved him like a father, but he was gone. She betrayed both heaven and her husband. The church would not have Monteverde or Melanthe, but neither would Navona or Riata have them either. She could not live a nun. She could not spend her days praying for her dead. They were too many. Belikely she would not be able to remember all their names, and would get into a great argument with God over the matter, and expire of black melancholy. Nay, if she must live inside walls for her protection, then let them be walls of her own choosing, this one time. The tournament procession poured out into the great level meadow, where a field of colour lined the entry to the lists. Vivid tents, some orange, some blue and scarlet, some formed like small castles, flying pennants from their multitude of peaks. Each bore the owner's arms upon a shield hung at the entrance. In the wake of the herald's trumpets, the parade moved past weapons and armour, caparisoned horses, and squires bowing deep in honour of Prince Edward and his brother. Melanthe received her homage also, but the cheers dulled as she passed. When she halted before a tent of green trimmed in silver, the voices nearby suspended entirely, creating a void, a space of silence within the music and the throng. Her green knight stood beside his warhorse, outfitted in full armour, sending silver sparks into the sunshine from the green metal. As she drew up, he bowed on one knee, his bared head bent so that she saw only the tousle of black hair, his male habergeon, and the tan, leather-padded edge of his gambeson against his neck.
"My liege lady," he said.
"Rise ye, beloved knight," she murmured formally. With an unmusical sound, the metallic note of armour, he came to his feet. She extended her free hand. Without raising his eyes to hers, he moved near and went down again on one leg to offer his knee as a pillion stone. Melanthe stepped from the saddle to the ground, lightly touching his bare hand for an instant before Kara hurried up to offer her support. The knight rose.
Melanthe soothed Gringalet with one finger as he caught his horse away from his hunchbacked servant. Kara melted back from close range when the knight led the huge destrier toward them, its caparison of emerald silk and dragonflies rippling at the hem as the warhorse moved. Having prompted this little play herself, Melanthe saw with wry relief that the twisted unicorn's horn, a yard long, had been replaced by a less threatening pointed cone upon the stallion's faceplate. The destrier's eyes were hidden behind steel blinders. It blew softly and chewed at the bit as the knight attached a silver cord to the bridle, presenting the lead to her with another bow of courtesy. She had not really expected to be left holding this enormous beast herself, but the broken-backed squire moved away to help his master with pulling the helm and avantail over the knight's head, quickly smoothing any crimp out of the mailed links that fell over his shoulders. Melanthe realized with some surprise that he seemed to have no other servant. He pushed up the visor with his fist, keeping a cautious eye on his horse as he pulled on his gauntlets. The uneasy moment passed without incident. He caught up the looping reins, holding them together at the stallion's shoulder as he stood by the stirrup. His plated gauntlets were so thick that his fingers seemed set in their half-curl, clumsy and skillful at once. For the first time, he looked directly at Melanthe. He said nothing, but there was a level strength in him, something quiet and open, without evasion. He seemed to wait, without expectation, with immeasurable steady patience in his green eyes, as impenetrable and beckoning as the silent shadows of a forest, and yet flickering with hints of secret animation, with its own mysterious life and will. Unexpectedly, Melanthe found she had no ready word, no deceptive smile to return. She felt as if she had been falling, and under his calm regard, found herself caught up from the endless drop and placed on solid ground. The horse threw its head, ringing bells. She shifted her look, the first to break away, and nodded to the knight. He turned to mount. His squire took hold of the reins below the bit, steadying the destrier. From the block, her champion swung up into the tourney saddle, adjusting his body against the high curve of the cantle. The little squire brought the lance. With a move that held the grace of countless repetitions, the hunchback swung the heavy spear aloft in an arc. The weapon slapped into the knight's waiting hand, slipped down against his open palm, and couched in the rest. At the spear point, the bells of Gringalet's jesses rang their hunter's music. He took up his shield with the image of the hooded falcon upon it, and looked down upon Melanthe. Sunlight caught the large emerald at the base of his green plumes.
"Say me thy right name," she said in English, in a low voice.
She heard herself ask it, heard the intensity of her own voice, standing amid the crowd of onlookers, not even knowing herself why she should care to know. His armor masked him now. All she saw was his shadowed face within the helm and visor. She thought he would not answer. He had sworn to be nameless, and yet there was no smell of subterfuge about him, an impossible contrast, new to her and unsettling in its strangeness. She felt a bizarre rush of shyness to have pressed him, and turned her face downward.
"Rook," he said.
She looked up, uncertain of the English word.
"As the black ravens call," he murmured in his own language. His mouth lifted with a half-smile. "Rook, my lady, be not such a fair name as yours, but runish."
There was no presumption, no bold arts of love or offers of certain delight, only that half-smile, rare and sweet and vanished in a moment. But Melanthe saw then in him what Allegretto had claimed to see, a man's hunger beneath the reserve. He sat mounted with his shield and lance, a warrior geared for combat. An uncouth runish name he might bear, but his armored figure aroused a thought in her that was stunning in its novelty. She was no longer married. She might take a friend, a lover, if she pleased. In the same moment that she thought it, she knew the impossibility. Nothing had changed. Gian Navona had grown smoothly savage over the years of waiting for his prize. He tolerated no gallant by her. Any man who could not be discouraged in his attentions would meet his fate by some insidious means, so subtle that only gossip and evil tales followed Melanthe. So subtle that she had learned to befriend no one and smiled upon no man, cold as winter now in her heart. She turned that icy disfavor upon the night, so that any who watched could see her do it. "I care naught for thy runish font name," she said, as if he'd been too dull to understand her. "What is thy court, knight?" He showed no reaction, but a turn of his thick gauntlet, gathering the reins.
"My court is yours, my lady," he said in French, "and his who rules the Palatine of Lancaster."
"If thou love me as thy liege," she said, "for today thy court is mine alone." She stared at him, to be certain that he took her meaning, a long moment with everything she knew of command in her eyes.
"Yea, then," he said slowly. "Yours only, my lady."
3. They called him by this north name of Bersaka with good reason. Melanthe was accustomed to games of combat. The innumerable hastiludes and tournaments and spectacles she had attended, celebrating every occasion from weddings to foreign embassies. A plaisance. Pleasantries, as Lancaster had promised. But with his blunted tournament weapons, her green knight fought as if he meant to kill. Melanthe had led him last into the lists, holding back until two lines had formed, opposing ranks of destriers and knights, their banners waving gently over the fantastical crests of staghorns and griffins and outlandish beasts, as if each man vied to display a deeper nightmare than the next atop his helm. Down the open space between, she led her green sire, halting at the centre to the sound of scattered, cool applause. The moment she had released his horse, a pair of pages in Lancaster's livery hurried up to her, catching her by the hand and escorting her to a place upon the escafeau below Prince Edward, on his red-draped couch and dais. She curtsied deeply to the prince and princess, then took her seat next to the Duke's empty chair. There was to be no old-fashioned melee. At the stout gate into the tilting ground, a monument of red stone held the insignia of the defenders. As each knight had ridden past in the procession, he had struck the shield of his choice to issue his challenge, and the green shield emblazoned with a silver falcon bore so many sword and lance wounds of challenge that the wood showed through the paint. Not every knight had touched it. Many had raised their weapons and brought them down as if they would hit the falcon, then at the last instant held back, bowing deliberately toward Lancaster, and struck some other arms. But even so, there were no less than a score of rivals beyond the Duke himself who had signalled a wish to fight for Melanthe's favour. The trumpets sounded, clearing the lists of all but Lancaster's swarm of attendants, and her champion with his single man. As the green sire reined his destrier into position, the jeers began. They would not sneer openly at Melanthe, but her champion was fair game, it seemed. The entire crowd burst into frenzied acclaim for Lancaster as the Duke rode forward into place, surrounded by his squires and grooms. The green sire made no sign of noticing either applause or taunts. He rested his lance upon the ground and slipped Gringolet's jesses from the tip. The marshal of the lists accepted responsibility for Melanthe's prize, riding back to the escafeau. As he handed her the jesses, both combatants lifted their lances in salute. Melanthe bowed to her champion, ignoring Lancaster. The trumpets clarioned. The lances swung downward. Both horses roused. The green knights half-reared and came down squarely, as Lancaster's was already trotting forward. The green destrier sprang off its haunches into a gallop. Lancaster's bay mount hit its stride, rolling the sound of hoofbeats over the stands and the crowd. An instant before impact, the green knight threw his shield away. The crowd roared, obscuring the sound as the lances hit. Lancaster's bounced upward, flying free and solid into the air, along with the shattered splinters of his opponent's weapon. The green sire pulled up at the far end of the list,
carrying half of a demolished tournament spear in one hand. Tossing away his shield was the entire extent of his consideration for his prince. In 5 more courses, he broke 5 lances on the duke, and took off Lancaster's helm on the 6th, whereupon the marshal threw down his white arrow to end the match. To Melanthe's displeasure, Lancaster accepted this without demur, not even demanding to go on to the foot combat. Amid a murmur that spoke faintly of disfavour from the crowd, the duke saluted Melanthe and his brother, and left the lists with his retinue. She had not counted upon such a paltry showing. Not even the partisan onlookers could accuse her of withholding her favour from him without reason. But when he joined her upon the escafot, he seemed unembarrassed. Gay, rather, speaking favourably of his opponent's skill to his brother Edward for a moment, before he sat down beside Melanthe. The musicians behind them struck up warbling tunes.
"A fair fight, my lady," he said. "Though your champion makes no fine distinction between battlefield and tourney, I only hope that he slays none of our guests."
She felt an irritated urge to rise to this bait. "He faced you without shield," she said shortly.
"Yea, so they told me, but indeed I did not know it until he took off my helm, or I should have done the same."
He raised his hand for refreshment, and took the cup his squire offered, drinking deeply.
"Or mayhap not. Marry, I have no desire to be run through in a joust and buried in unconsecrated ground."
He laughed, but there was a glitter of deeper emotion in him. Melanthe watched him as he drained the wine, tossed the cup down, and turned back to the lists with relish. This was some artificial show. She felt it, studying his unabashed countenance. It was not over yet. Not at all. Lancaster had no intention of concluding with such a poor display. She turned a look of better humour upon him.
"I will not believe you stand in such peril, sir. Come, you will fight again, will you not?"
The flicker of hesitation told her all that she need know.
"Why, nay, madam, I will take my ease at your side if you will be kind. Here, now comes your champion into the lists again."
A challenger, emblazoned in gold and black, and crested by the gilt head of a leopard, was being led into position by 2 squires, while Melanthe's knight circled his courser and backed it into place. He had resumed his fighting shield. The lances dipped. A gold and black squire shouted and stabbed a stick into the rump of the other horse. The animal jumped forward under the goad, galloping wildly, half shying as her champion stallion bore down upon it. The green lance caught its target full in the chest. With a jerk, he sailed from the saddle as the horse went down. They somersaulted in opposite directions, the destrier hauling itself upright in a flail of hooves and caparisons to trot intemperately about the list, evading attempts to capture it.
"Poorly mounted," Lancaster murmured dryly.
The gold challenger struggled to his feet, pulling off his helmet and demanding his axe. The green sire dismounted, changing to a bassinet helm and sending the visor down with a clamp, as the hunchback led his mount away. The challenger came at him, swinging a long-handled axe. It whirred past his shoulder as he stepped aside. He lifted his weapon and took a single cut behind his opponent's knees. The other man fell, and one more murderous strike, blade on to his helmet, slicing an edge through the metal, was enough to make him shout pax. He was bleeding at the temple when his squire pulled off his helmet. They did not proceed to the sword combat. While the musicians played harmonious melodies, and Melanthe sat calmly beside Lancaster, her champion smashed the pretensions of 3 more challengers. 2 lances were shattered on him, but no contender fought as far as the swords, and 1 left the first course of axes with a broken hand. Outside the lists, where common men-at-arms mingled with the squires and pages, there was a small but growing band of onlookers who met the Green Sire's victories with a ragged volley of cheers. Melanthe made no sign herself, but a feeling of pleasant awe began to steal over her, watching him fight. Berserker indeed. It only remained to see that Lancaster be fired to face her champion again. Melanthe already suspected the Duke's intention. To allow a goodly number of challengers, wearing his rival down and painting him invincible at the same time,
Then, perhaps, a private visitation by some secret friend, warning him of his prince's displeasure, and designed to shake his nerve. And somehow, Lancaster, fresh from hours of relaxation in the stands, would find a reason to meet the Green Sire at the end of the day. She could appreciate Lancaster's design. It required a fine judgment. Melanthe smiled inwardly as he lifted a finger to communicate with the Marshal of the Lists, who instantly caused the heralding of a new set of combatants, allowing the Green Sire his first rest. It would not do to have him appear too easy, and just as vital to properly exhaust him before the coup de grace. Melanthe prepared to ensure that the Duke misjudged his moment. She toyed with the jeweled jesses, turning a disinterested look on the new jousters. "Tell me of my champion," she said. "He is nameless, in truth?"
"Nameless, yea, my lady. A nobody. He gives homage and claims our service, but brings no men of his own beyond that malformed squire."
"No lands, then? But such rich gear, and such a great warhorse. He has won many prizes in tournament, I expect." The Duke laughed.
"Few enough, for I've better use for him in real fighting. But it is true that when he enters the lists, he prevails. I have sometimes sent him on a dragon hunt for sport, but he brings me no prize yet."
"And still he has not proved himself worthy of his name?"
Lancaster turned his palm up casually. "The fortunes of war and dragons, my lady. All must await their great chance at honour, if it ever comes." He shrugged. "Perhaps he has no name. God only must know where he thieved his gear. It's my thought that he is naught but a freeman."
"A freeman?"
Melanthe turned in amazement. "Else why hide his lineage? That falcon device is recorded on no roll of rightful arms, so say the heralds. But the Green Sire has a talent to lead common soldiers. What men he commands, they come to love him. And the French dread his name. No great chivalry in that, but it is a useful art."
He leaned back in his chair and smiled.
"So, we tolerate his odds and his unlawful device and green horse, princess. And if he likes to call you his liege lady for a fantasy, then we will enjoy the game."
Melanthe swung the jesses lightly between her fingers, drawing them over the back of his hand. "A poor game to the present, my lord. Know you of no man strong enough to win my favour from this odd knight?"
Lancaster caught up the jesses and kissed them. The bells rang brightly. "I shall find one, princess," he murmured. "Fear not for that."
Furious shouts drowned the music as a fistfight broke out between a foot soldier and a youth from the retinue of a defeated challenger. Lancaster watched until some of the guards had separated them, and then turned again to Melanthe.
"Will you take wine, my lady? The dust rises."
At his words, Kara stood up from her stool behind, placing a tray between their chairs to offer the ewer and goblets. As the Duke reached to pour, Melanthe sat back in her seat with a pert moo of impatience.
"Nay, sir, I shall not."
She waved Kara away.
"This sport is too tame. I vow by St. John, my lord, nothing, food nor drink, shall pass my lips until a new champion wins my admiration."
He lifted his brows, his hand poised with the ewer.
"So eager, my lady? The day is long and the earth dry."
"So it is," she agreed. She trifled with the jesses, allowing the bells to tinkle. "But I am dauntless. Indeed, I challenge you to join me and dedicate your comfort to this quest. Surely it is little enough to venture."
She glanced at him beneath her lashes.
"As you do not bestir yourself to fight for my prize again."
Lancaster's mouth showed a very faint tautening. She saw the struggle in him, pride against guile. But he smiled at last and nodded toward her.
"As you will, my lady."
He set down the ewer.
"By St. John, I vow it. No food or drink shall I take until you are satisfied with a new champion."
As the noon passed, Melanthe sat upon the escafeau, fanning herself conspicuously with a green plume. The day was clement enough that winter clothing weighed heavily.
The Duke, in his blue and crimson houppelande, was a little flushed at the neck, his crown resting on hair that curled damply, darkened against his temple. The Black Prince, fretful and complaining of his swollen joints, had retired with his wife, carried in his litter from the stands to the shade of a magnificent tent set a little back from the noise and dirt. As each new course of jousting sent dust into the air, Melanthe covered her mouth with a scarf and coughed lightly to convey her discomfort. She looked with a great show of longing at a tray of lozenges and cream tarts that passed en route to some other guests. The Duke made no such indication of interest, but she was pleased to note that he swallowed once, after the wine had traversed their view. The Green Sire was handily trouncing all comers. Melanthe sighed, watching a knight outfitted in a boar's head helm pick himself up from a fall, the boar's tusks smashed and drooping askew.
"I weary of these trials," she said. "Has he some magic, or be your men all weak as willow wands?"
"No magic, my lady, but goodly strength and skill," Lancaster said. "He, too, is mine," he added in a cool reminder.
Melanthe returned a taunting smile to that, and casually jingled her bells. The noise of the onlookers grew, a confusion of cheers and scorn, passions flourishing as support for the Green Sire seemed to increase, scattered widely now among the mixed crowd below. Around the stout fence that enclosed the lists, youths and attendants thronged beside men-at-arms, all pressing as close as they could, while the next combatant and his retinue surged through the gate. The Green Sire pulled off his great helm, bending awkwardly to wipe his eyes and forehead with the tail of his tunic. A man-at-arms shouted, ducking through the fence to hand him a clean cloth. His intrusion past the lawful barrier sparked a great roar. In the stands, noble ladies shrilled their disapproval, answered by impudent shouts from some of the common soldiers below. Another scuffle broke out and spread. Melanthe felt the Duke tense beside her, but his guards moved quickly, laying about with clubs and staves and hauling the brawlers away. Lancaster made another subtle signal to the marshal, and the next challenge heralded was without the Green Sire. Melanthe watched as her champion left the gate. He and his squire were surrounded instantly by soldiers and commoners, who made a phalanx about his horse and escorted him through the mob toward the tents.
"But if you allow him yet more rest, my lord," she complained petulantly, "what chance have these beardless children to defeat him?"
Lancaster swung a goaded look upon her. She swished the plume lightly.
"There are other matches to be fought, princess," he said. "We have 100 knights who desire to joust."
"I suppose my champion has not time to fight them all," she murmured, "though I vow I had not truly supposed him the greatest of the lot. I believe my father or brother could have knocked him down several times over."
He managed a creditable smile.
"Perhaps so, my lady, but the day is not yet gone."
"I despair of surprises at this late hour," she shook her head. "The great days of the tournaments are past. We have only boys' games now. The king, your father, God's blessing upon him, would find this a pale image of the splendid spectacles he has hosted."
Lancaster had become quite red now about the neck, but still he only nodded, stiffly polite.
"There is naught to surpass the tournaments of our beloved lord the king."
Melanthe gazed upon the pair now thundering toward each other. To her pleasure and the crowd's sneers, they missed each other entirely, a commonplace in any ordinary pas de arme, but the first time it had occurred today. She clucked ruefully.
"I suppose the Italians care more for their honour in these matters," she commented. "They take their ease upon the hearthrug instead of in the lists, and joust like gallant men before the ladies."
Lancaster made a sudden move, sitting straighter in his chair. A page moved quickly to him. They bent their heads together for an instant, and then the Duke rose.
"You will forgive my discourtesy, Your Highness,"
he bowed deeply.
"A summons from my brother the Prince. I regret I must leave your companionship a while."
Melanthe acknowledged him with good grace.
"Be pleased to go at once," she said. "With my health and dear friendship, may God keep our esteemed Lord Edward the Prince."
He turned, with a degree less than his usual elegance, and strode down the steps behind his page. The musicians continued to play their merry melody. Melanthe looked after him, fanning herself slowly and smiling. The crowd had grown dangerously restless with the lesser jousts, and Lancaster was still missing from the escafot by the time the herald's trumpets blew a great fanfare, silencing the musicians and the noise. The marshal of the lists held up his arms and strode to the center of the ground, his slashed sleeves showing blue under scarlet, and his cape flying out behind him.
"Now comes the one who will take their measure!" he shouted. "The one who will take their measure has arrived!"
As he declared the ritual words, old as the legends of King Arthur and Lancelot, the throng burst into frenzy. The discharge of sound beat against Melanthe's ears like the blare of the trumpets themselves. From between the tents came a knight the color of blood sunset, galloping with his black lance balanced on one hand above his head, his armor shining reddish gold. He rode a massive black destrier encased in the same shimmering metal. His shield was sable, as dark as his lance and horse, without device or color. He dragged his mount to a halt at the stone monument. A hush fell over the onlookers. Delicious expectation. A carnal pleasure in this drama. The black lance poised, and came down on the silver falcon, rocking it with force of the blow. The shield he had chosen rang with a wooden resonance as the cheers hit a new plane of passion. A outrance. The black lance had no safe coronal to blunt it, but a sharp tip. The shield it had struck was not the battered falcon with the hood, but the one that hung above it, with the silver bird of prey unhooded, offering combat a outrance, beyond all limits. A joust of war, fought to the death, with real weapons. His attendants came behind him, a full score, masked, dressed as fools in rainbow colors, playing flutes and hunting horns. The curling toes of their shoes were so long and pointed that they were attached by belled chains at the knee. They made a grotesque fantasy behind the blood-gold knight, an uncanny contrast to his hostile silence. Amid the cries and tumult, Melanthe's green knight rode out to meet him, armed with a sharpened lance. She pressed her palms together and tasted the salt on her fingertips, then folded her hands and held Gringalet's jesses motionless in her lap. The hunting horns mingled their clear notes with the trumpets, rising higher and higher into the air. They broke off, one by one, leaving a single carol from the herald's horn to ascend and echo back from the stands and the river and the city walls, dying away like an angel's voice. The knights saluted Melanthe, the golden one with an extra flourish. As they faced their mounts toward each other, the green sire pulled his arm from within the leather straps and threw his shield away. He knew it. Melanthe knew it. The crowd guessed it, and burst into a furore of scandalized exultation as the man hidden inside the ruddy gold armor tossed down his blank shield in answer. When the lances couched level, an instant of silent anticipation blanketed the onlookers. The black horse threw its head and charged. The green sire spurred his destrier. In the hush, the thunderous roll of the animal's hooves made the wood beneath Melanthe's feet vibrate. The lances impacted with the sound of fractured bone, of 100 hammers against steel. Both knights fell backward and sideways, clinging to smashed lances, hanging half off their mounts against the weight of armor as the onlookers broke into an uproar. The rainbow attendants rushed to propel their master back into place and supply him with a fresh lance. He was already at the charge before the green sire had hauled himself upright and grabbed his new lance from the hunchback. As the green spear swung up, tipped to the sky, Melanthe realized that he had it in the wrong hand to meet his opponent. A sound like a great moan rose from the crowd. His dancing mount froze in place. As the challenger realized his advantage, he aimed for the most vital target, leveling the black lance at his adversary's head. The green knight didn't even attempt to compel his horse forward, but faced the oncoming lance and rider as if he were entranced. The onlooker's groan rose to voluptuous agony. Then, the green sire seemed to collapse. An instant before the black spear hit his faceplate, he and his lance both toppled sideways, a sheer perpendicular to his course. As the tip of the black spear grazed his helm, the green lance swung down across his opponent's path. The rod took the golden knight flat across his belly. In a crash of plated metal he seemed to fly, bent double for a suspended instant across the lance, as the green destrier sat down on its haunches, scrambling against the force of the butt end jammed between the green sire's thigh and the pommel. Melanthe found herself on her feet with everyone else. She stared at the fallen knight stretched on his back on the ground. When he moved, rising drunkenly, his golden armor dimmed by dust, she sat down. The green destrier wheeled and galloped after the loose horse, scattering the attendants as if they were colorful leaves. Leaning to catch the reins, her champion flipped them over the black's head, just as his mount danced away from a vicious kick. The horses trotted together to the little hunchback, who took the black as if it were a palfrey instead of a trained warhorse, and the animal lowered its head, submitting instantly, as if it recognized that a man without armor was no enemy. The squire led the captured horse out of the gate. Melanthe looked away from the dirty golden challenger as he swayed to his feet, shaking off his attendant's aid. The green sire sat fixed upon his horse, gazing toward her. The nameless challenger drew his sword, shouting within his helm. Still her knight did not move, but stared toward Melanthe. The great helm showed only menace, its eye slits black and empty. But she saw beyond, saw a man on his knees in the great hall, looking up at her with intense entreaty. She allowed herself no change of expression, gazing steadily back. The red-gold challenger shouted again. Her knight turned and swung down from his horse, jerking his sword from its sheath. His squire ran up to him with his shield and bassinet helm, but the challenger was already running forward, aiming a great swing with a sword that took the sun to its tip, shining murderous steel. The hunchback ducked away, dragging the destrier with him. Her knight met the blow with an upward cut. The weapons rang and the crowd cheered. Neither man gave way as the blows fell, denting helmets and armor. They fought as barbarians fought, without mercy. The golden knight slashed over and over at her champion's neck, killing blows, pivoting and swinging back again. He landed a strike that made the green sire stumble sideways, but her knight seemed better at mischance even than advantage, turning his sword hand down and slicing sideways beneath his adversary's arm, cutting through the vambrace strap. The challenger's plate flapped loose, exposing vulnerable chainmail above his elbow. He did not appear to realize it, whipping his sword again toward his opponent's helmet. It struck, driving a deep dent in the steel. Under the force of the blow, the green knight's sword seemed to fly from his hand. But then it was in his left, as if he'd snatched it from the air. He brought it overhead, striking an arc downward, the sharpened edge aimed for his adversary's outstretched arm, with a force that would slice through chainmail and bone alike. Sunlight flashed on the broad side of the blade. Melanthe closed her eyes. She heard it hit, and the golden knight's grunt of pain was audible an instant before the throng burst into noisy reaction. She blinked her eyes open. The challenger was hauling himself up off the ground, but he could not seem to gain any purchase on his sword. The green sire stood over him, looking up again at Melanthe. She had full expected to see the blood-gold arm severed and covered in real gore, but it was still attached to its owner, only rendered useless. The golden knight was groping for his sword with his left hand, his other hanging ineffectually at his side. The marshal had stepped forward, poised with his white arrow, but the fallen challenger shouted furiously at him. The official hesitated, his hand wavering, and then bowed and stepped back. The red-gold knight rolled, pushing himself to his feet with his good arm. Melanthe's champion took a step toward her, the black eye-slits in his helm still focused in her direction. She could see his heavy breathing at the edges of his hauberk. He lifted his hand, palm up in petition. Melanthe saw the red-gold opponent achieve his feat. He shouted, his words obscured and echoing within the helm, and raised his sword with his left arm. She ignored her champion's appeal, staring at him coldly. The challenger ran forward. The green sire turned, met the sword, and threw it off. He thrust the tip of his weapon at the golden knight's helm, catching the visor's edge, shoving the whole helmet upward, half off. Blinded, the other man ducked away, flailing his wounded arm and his sword to reset the helm, but another blow took it completely off. It rolled across the ground. A great roar swelled from the crowd. Lancaster stood swaying in the middle of the dusty list. One of his attendants grabbed the helmet and ran toward him. Her green knight turned yet again to Melanthe. He lifted his sword and shoved his helmet off his head with both hands, throwing the armor away from him. He pushed back his mail coif. Sweat streaked his face, stained with rust from inside the helm, marking the edge of his curling, half-plastered black hair. He did not look toward Lancaster, but still to her, breathing in great deep gusts. She watched the attendants re-helm their master, and then met her champion's silent plea with calm indifference. He closed his eyes and turned his face upward, like a man under torture. The Duke rushed at him. Without helm, the green sire came on guard. He ducked his liege's left-handed swing and pressed close inside the other man's reach, nullifying the lack of a helmet. Lancaster tried to grapple him with both arms, but the injured one would not lift past his waist. The Duke's sword cut awkwardly across the back of the green sire's head, spreading crimson on black curls and mail. The blades locked at their hilts, crossed, pointing at the sky, shaking with the force of each man's strength. Lancaster made a hard shove, turning his sword inward between them, trying to slash it into the Green Knight's unprotected face. The tip sliced her champion's cheek, but he used the sudden motion to thrust his elbow back and up in one vicious lunge, ramming the guard against Lancaster's fist, breaking the Duke's hold on his weapon. The Duke made a desperate recovery, trying to retain his blade. The sword dropped, the tip lodging for an instant against the earth, just as Lancaster caught it. As he stumbled, the Green Knight's blade came up broadside against his helmet. He fell sideways over the lodged sword, his exclamation of agony audible above the noise as he hit the ground on his injured side. He rolled onto his back. The Green Sire stood above his liege, sword point at his throat. Lancaster lay weaponless, injured, felled, and still made no surrender. The crowd held its breath so still that the panting of the two knights seemed the loudest sound. Her champion looked up at her, holding the sword steady. The blood on his face and hair was darkening, gathering dust. He looked like a devil risen from some pit, imploring her to save him.
"My lady!"
The words were an exhalation of despair. Melanthe lifted her plume and fanned herself. She laughed aloud in the silence so they could all hear.
"Yes, thou mayst have pity on him," she said, with a mocking bow of her head.
Her knight pulled his sword from the Duke's throat and flung it half across the list. As Lancaster sat up, the Green Sire fell on his knees before his prince, head bowed. He pressed his gauntleted hands over his eyes. Slowly, like a tree falling, he leaned lower and lower until his hands and forehead touched the ground.
"Pax, my dread lord."
His muffled voice was agonized.
"Peace unto you."
Painfully, Lancaster hauled himself to his feet, standing against the support of one of his attendants. Still in his helmet, he seemed to overlook the man in the dirt at his feet. He searched out Melanthe on the escafot, and then turned his back to her, walking unsteadily out of the lists, with his attendants clustering about him. Melanthe rose and descended the steps. As she walked toward the gate, youths and men-at-arms and onlookers parted, gazing at her. She moved to the center of the dusty lists, where the Green Knight still knelt with his face to the ground, blood matting his hair and staining his neck.
"Green Sire," she said mildly.
He sat back, staring for a long moment at the hem of her gown. Then he wiped his gauntlet across his eyes, smearing blood with rust. He turned his face up to her. All light of worship and chivalry was gone from his look. He was still breathing hard, his teeth pressed together to contain it. She knelt and reached for his right arm, tying the jesses about the vambrace and mail. The heat of his body radiated from metal armor. Gringalet's varvels made a silvery plink against his arm, the precious stones casting tiny sprays of light that played over steel, coalescing green and white as the rings came to rest. On a level with him, she looked up from her task into his eyes. She could not have said what she saw there, hatred or misery or bewilderment, but it was surely not love that stared back at her from under his begrimed black lashes. From the persistent tickle of recollection, memory sprang sudden and full-blown into her mind. Once, long ago, for a whim, she had pulled a thorn from this lion's paw. She remembered him. She remembered when and where. An image stirred more by his height and bearing and the baffled agony in his face than by his features. Just so he had submitted, disarmed of all defense, as they took away his wife and money from him. He repaid her today, then, for that emerald on his helm. Whatever precarious place he had striven to gain in Lancaster's heart, with his fighting skills and command of men and vow to find glory, was vanished now. He knelt before her like a man dazed. Apology sprang to her lips, regret for his maimed honor, his lost prince. It hovered on her tongue. "Thou'rt a fool," she murmured instead, "to think a man can serve two masters." She lifted a varvel and let it fall against his armor, smiling. "A splendid fool. Come into my service to stay. Be it thy desire." He stared at her. A sound like a sob escaped him, a deeper breath, harsh through his teeth. Melanthe rose. She extended her hand, touching his shoulder to make a gesture for the crowd. "Rise!" His squire brought the destrier forward. Melanthe took the silver lead. They smelled of sweat and dust and hot steel, the knight and his mount, perfumed with blood and combat. When he had mounted, she looked up at him. "If thou art vassal unto me," she said, "I shall love and value thee as Lancaster never could." And with that snare said, she turned before he answered, leaving his hunchbacked squire to lead him from the lists.
"Away! Away!"
Melanthe held Gringalet on her wrist, urging the flustered falconers of Ombrière to haste.
"I will away!"
She turned her palfrey in the castle's empty courtyard, watched only by her own retinue and a few dumbstruck servants. Outside the walls, the sound of the tournament was a distant rise and fall of temper, the tensions between soldiers and squires and townsmen flaring. Melanthe cared nothing for that. It was the Duke's difficulty if he could not control his people. She only wanted escape from the tumult, releasing her own tensions in a flying gallop over the countryside with Gringalet aloft before her. Allegretto stood sullenly under the arched entrance to the hall, waiting for a horse, one of his eyes turning black from his morning in the town stocks. He had not had a difficult time of it. No taunting of a foreign stranger could equal the excitement of a tournament, but he glared at Melanthe all the same. Her greyhound strained against its leash as Melanthe felt her heart strain for the open country. She had seen herons and ducks by the river. Yesterday, Lancaster had given her his leave to take what she could, and if he regretted it now, she was beyond having to care. The falconers, two underlings left behind to mind the mews, finally secured their drum and swung up double onto a thin, poorly horse, carrying a trussed chicken in a bag, in case the hunt should have no success. Melanthe reined her palfrey toward the gate, across the bridge and through the barbican, and she could turn away from tournaments and courts and crowds, and pretend she was alone with the open sky. Alone, as Gringalet flew, but for the escort of hunters and falconers that chased the bird's wild courses. Melanthe, too, was followed. Allegretto and Cara and Arrieta rode behind her. Lancaster and Jan Navona and the ghost of Ligurio hounded her. And another hunted her now. The image of a man in green armor, bending slowly to the ground with his hands covering his eyes. All of them her constant companions, ever in pursuit, never lost to sight. Spur her horse as she might, she was only free as the falcon flew free, until she killed, or was called back again to the brilliant jewels and feathers of her lure. 4. A witch, she was. Ruck stood beside one of the shadowed columns in the cathedral, staring blindly at the scaffolding beneath a newly installed stained glass window. He felt robbed. He felt utterly pillaged. Where was his lady, his bright, unblemished lady, love-lockest of all, who made the blood and boredom and solitary days worth bearing? He hadn't asked that she be with him. He had never thought he was that worthy. But he had held himself to her standard. When they laughed at him, when he hurt for a woman's body to the point of despair, he cleaved to the impossible measure that she set by her own perfection. He had dreamed about her in his bed or on the cold ground. He saw her beside the Virgin in the churches. He even imagined her with Isabel in the nunnery, praying for his soul, both of them together, both of them the same, fair blue eyes and fair blonde tresses, and a face too lovely for any woman on earth. He turned his head and rested his bandaged temple against the pillar. The cut across his skull burned. His cheek stung and throbbed in spite of Pierre's salve. The reality of Princess Melanthe had been like a bucket of ice-cold water thrown in his face. He was angry at himself, but he reserved his deepest fury and disgust for her. The witch. She probably had ensorcelled him. How else could he have managed to forget what she was? The arch-fiend's whore. That was what she was, curling like a silken tiger on the bed with her Satan's cub caressing her. He could not even find the image of fairness anymore. It had vanished from his soul, blasted by the sight of sable hair and eyes the color of unearthly twilight, the deep, strange inner hue of hellish flowers. He recognized them now, but he had not remembered them so vivid dark, or her coldness so numbing. She had laughed. He could hear it still, like an echo in the empty cold air of the cathedral, floating above the endless murmur of the priest's chantries. The sound was branded on him. He had stood with sword point to the throat of his gallant liege, who had fought on, wounded, unbowed, with no thought of submission. And she had laughed. The windows glowed with the last faint light of day, spreading colored radiance over the floors and columns, subtle warmth in the soaring blackness. Beyond the cathedral walls he could hear faint sounds of celebration. A few knights came and went in the nave, kneeling to cleanse themselves with prayer, and one youth had been keeping solitary vigil in the lady chapel for hours. Ruck stayed to himself, using the pillar for a prop when his cushion grew too uncomfortable for his knees. Outside of duty and the exercise yard, he spent most of his waking hours in chapels or cathedrals or churches of one sort or another. At first, it had been the hardest effort of his knighthood, tedious to the point of screaming agony. But after 13 years, he had come to peace with the cold stone spaces and the fact that his knees could not support hours on the cushion. He stood now more than he knelt, sparing his frame for the field and fighting, sparing his soul with a regular confession of this small sin. He never even got a real penance, the priests being sympathetic in the matter. He seldom prayed during his hours in church. Isabel, he'd thought, would be doing that for him better than he could for himself. He'd often imagined her at it, her face alight and the tears flowing, the other holy women ranged behind her. He felt closer to her in the churches and chapels, where he could banish the faint fear that she never thought about him at all. Sometimes he envisioned her in nun's robes, more often in a sparkling gown of green and silver. And the lonelier the road, the bloodier the combat, the more beautifully and brilliantly she glowed, almost as real as if she stood in the shadows holding her falcon. It came as a sickening jolt to him now to realize just how often he had confused them in that way. His wife and his nameless liege lady. They had somehow, across the years, within the stark isolation of his heart, melded together into a single female image. And he had spent his adult life in rigid devotion to her. Celibate, devout, courteous, refusing to stoop to dishonor and bribes of money to win the favor of his prince. Never had he been invited into his lord's inner chamber, yet he had waited patiently for God to send his chance. He had risen slowly in Lancaster's service, earning his place in spite of the half-concealed amusement. He would lead men-at-arms and archers against the French. He would play at unicorn if he must. Dragons he would hunt when his liege commanded. He knew the other knights preferred him safely away from court on such commissions. He was mad in action, so they claimed. Dangerous, unreliable, by which they meant that he gave no quarter, demanding surrender when surrender galled them, the only way he had been taught to fight. But he had never lost the certainty that he would find a means of proving himself and winning his lord's boon. The stained glass panel above him was a lancet, blue and rose, glowing with a painting of the Virgin and Child. Ruck gazed at the Blessed Mother's pensive face, as she looked down at the baby Jesus. He ached with grief and anger. It appalled him to realize what he had done, how the years had gone by, how he had deluded himself and confused her with his pure, sweet wife, tainting his memory, his only connection to Isabel, who even now must be devoting herself to solitary worship, alone as he was. He was sure that she must have taken vows of seclusion and silence in the convent. For even though he sent money and tender greetings every year to Saint-Cloud, she never wrote him back. He only received an acknowledgement of his gift from the abbess, with no word from Isabel, even by proxy. Her loss seemed a fresh wound now, stinging as sharp as the cuts on his cheek and head. He missed her, and he could hardly recall her face. All he saw clearly were purple hellflower eyes and a white flash of skin. All he felt plainly were wrath and anguish, and the degrading burn of his body's appetite in spite of everything. He struggled to remember Isabel, to rededicate himself to the purer image, and could not. She was lost now, by his own folly, as lost as the bright illusion that had sustained him. Outside, the bell rang to signal curfew. Ruck leaned down and retrieved his cushion, scowling at the worn white threads of the embroidered falcon that adorned it. He thought of having it ripped out and replaced with the azure ground and black wolf of Wolfscar, but to take up his own true arms now, in disillusionment instead of honor, seemed the final defilement of his dreams. He left the falcon be. He left all of his green and silver vestiture as it was, determined to wear it as a constant reminder to himself of how a woman, this woman, could twist a man's mind into the fiend's knots. As he pushed out the great wooden door onto the stone porch, his head aching, a hard hand cuffed his shoulder. Three guards in Lancaster's livery stood just beside him. They offered silent sketches of bows, and one nodded toward the outer entrance. Pierre hung back in a corner of the porch, looking terrified. Ruck glanced at him and at the guards.
"Ye alone are summoned, my lord,"
one of them said. His tone was curt, but not hostile. Ruck nodded. The door opened to the last of twilight spilling over the city roofs. The streets were already deep in shadow, but sparked with torches and wandering groups of revellers. They showed no sign of extinguishing their fires and going to lodgings in answer to the curfew. It was often so on tournament days, and armed guards usually much in evidence, but this evening every man they passed was armed, common soldiers mixing with the city watch. Colourful retainers of the tourneying knights roamed drunkenly with their swords still at their hips.
"God's love," Ruck muttered. "This is ripe to go ill."
The guard at his side grunted an assent, but he did nothing to urge anyone to go home, only lengthened his stride, grabbing Ruck's elbow to direct him into an alley. As they came out on the other end, a hoarse voice yelled,
"Hark ye!"
an English soldier came weaving drunkenly toward them.
Our lord!
His companions followed, their wayward steps enlivened by this new goal. Suddenly, Ruck and his escort were surrounded by ungoverned men-at-arms, all of them familiar faces to Ruck, scowling and sullen with drink.
Unhand our liege, dog!
A soldier tried to pull Lancaster's guard away from Ruck.
Will you not take him?
The guard's hands went instantly to their weapons, but Ruck shoved the soldier back.
I am no liege of thine, he snapped. Watch thy tongue, fool! 'Tis stupid with ale! He will not have you, my lord, a man shouted from the back. Nor throwing you in prison for his pride!
Ruck glared.
Get ye gone to your places. The curfew tolled a quarter hour since. He will not arrest you!
There were other men accumulating now, attracted to the shouts, crowding nearer.
He goes through us first!
If you run mad, Ruck exclaimed, disperse, I order it!
Some of the ones nearest him made attempts to turn, as if to obey, but the growing wall of men behind them blocked their way. Lancaster's guards stood with their swords at ready, a tense triangle around him.
Disperse! Ruck bellowed. I am summoned by the Duke! Out of my way, Horson!
He shoved viciously at the soldier nearest. The man lurched backward, creating a momentary opening. Roaring his displeasure and intention, Ruck knocked another one aside. The path, begun by force, began to open of its own accord. Lancaster's guards came with him, but he stayed in front of them to show that he was not in duress. The way cleared before him. Though he didn't look, he was aware that the men did not scatter, but only fell back, following close at his escort's heels. He cursed them silently, deliberately taking a route down narrow alleys and close streets to spread them out into a weaker force. But outside the bannered lodgings of the highest nobles, the curfew was no more in force than in the lower street, though it was full dark now. Knights and valets reeled in and out of the bright doorways, young squires singing war songs and scuffling. Ruck strode past, his eyes straight ahead, but his luck did not hold. A youth in blue and white reached out and grabbed his cloak. He jerked it free, but not before he'd been recognized. Shouts erupted, and as the men-at-arms issued from the narrow passage behind, they began to run, pressing up around Ruck, elbowing the noble retainers back. More men began to pour out of the doorways, filling the street with shouting shadows, with torches, and the glint of steel. Ruck seized a faggot and jumped atop an upended barrel. He lifted it high, waving it so that sparks flared.
What folly is this? He roared. Silence!
For an instant, his voice caught their attention.
Who are ye?
He shouted.
The Duke's soldiers! The Duke's knights and their squires! I am the Duke's man! He calls me to him! Will you forestall me? Fight among ye, Selwyn, if ye be great fools enow, but hinder me in obeying him, and I'll see every villain of you with your guts strung on the city walls.
The silence held, a sullen acknowledgement. Threat or no, there was nothing that they wanted better than a reason to brawl, drunk as they were, commoners and gentles alike. He did not stay to see them come to that inevitable conclusion, but tossed the torch into a watering trough below him. It gave him a moment while they were still dazzled blind. He jumped down and slid between the crowd and a building's wall, using the shadows for cover to get away. The Duke of Lancaster had his arm in a sling. In his capacity as Lieutenant of Aquitaine, he sat sprawled on a throne, the walls and floor of the chamber draped in cloth woven with the arms of England and France. The flood of richly coloured squares obscured the shape of the room, so that it seemed to Ruck that he and the men he faced floated in a bowl of gilded red and blue. At the Duke's side stood his brother, the Earl of Cambridge. Ruck recognized their counsellors, Sir Robert Knollys, Thomas Felton, and the Earl of Bowen, men of military craft, veterans of all the savage campaigns of France and Spain.
Get up, knight, Lancaster said with a deep sigh.
Ruck stood, sliding a secret look toward him. The Duke appeared wakeful, but he had a sleepiness about his eyes that Ruck had seen before in men hit upon the head. His counsellors had barely glanced at Ruck as he entered,
but kept their close attention on Lancaster. Sir Robert scowled, standing by a table set with wine and food. The Duke stared at Ruck for a long time, his eyes half-lidded.
"It was," he said slowly, "a good fight."
A great wave of relief fountained through Ruck. He wanted to go down on his knees again and beg forgiveness, but he kept his feet, only saying,
"For the honour of the princess, my dread lord."
Lancaster laid his head back and laughed. His eyes focused from their drift with a sharper look at Ruck.
"She has made fools of us both, has she not? Hell-born bitch."
"My lord's grace,"
Sir Robert said warningly.
"Ah, but my sentiment will not leave this chamber, if this green fellow hopes to avoid my most grievous displeasure, and such jeopardy for him as that may entail."
"My life is at my lord's pleasure," Ruck said.
Lancaster sat up, leaning forward on his good arm, his mouth tightened against the pain of the movement.
"See that thou dost not forget it. What is thy judgment of the temper outside?"
Ruck hesitated. Then he said,
"Uneasy, my lord."
"Clear the street, sire,"
Felton said. Lancaster turned a sneer on the constable.
"With what? Your men-at-arms? They're the ones in the streets, making mischief in the name of this green nobody."
"They have not been paid, my lord," Felton said without embarrassment.
"And is that my fault?"
Lancaster shouted, and then squeezed his eyes shut, laying his head back.
"I'll run my own coffers dry in the defence of your damned Gascon barons.
The prince, your brother,
the prince, my brother, is sick unto death. He is to know nothing of this. Do not disturb him."
There was a little silence. Then the constable said tentatively,
"I believe, if my lord's grace appeared with this knight,"
he made a faint gesture toward Ruck,
"they would obey this man, my lord, if he ordered them to submit to curfew."
"By God!" Lancaster exclaimed. "He knocks me off my horse and holds his sword to my neck, and now I'm to stand by him while he gives orders to the men-at-arms? Why not appoint him lieutenant and be done with it?"
Ruck pressed his lips together, appalled. He had felt the threat hovering over him. Now it crystallized into real danger. He had never thought Lancaster would imprison him for pride. But suddenly a new and horrifying vista opened. The Duke seemed to catch his mute response, for he looked again at Ruck. He stared for a long, speculative moment, an assessment that chilled Ruck to the bone.
"What thinkest thee, green sire?" he said in a serious voice. "Canst thou control them?"
"My lord's grace has the right of it," Ruck said. "Methink it not seemly."
"But thou canst do it?"
"It be unmeet, my lord,"
Ruck repeated, trying to prevent any note of alarm from entering his voice.
"It be not wise."
"But if I cannot command them, nor their own constable here, and thou only canst keep the city from strife and riot?"
Ruck shook his head.
"I pray you, dread lord, ask it not of me."
"I ask it of thee. I command thee to take charge of the garrison and the men-at-arms and control them."
Yesterday such a command would have been a wonder for Ruck, a victory. Today it was the edge of a pit, the precipice of war between nobles and common soldiers, rebellion with himself at the center.
"My lord," he burst out, "reconsider. Your head pains you to folly."
He sucked in his breath, as if he could take back the brazen words as soon as they escaped. Lancaster rubbed his face with his good hand and looked to Sir Robert.
"My head pains me in truth," he said with something of a smile. "What think you of him?"
Knollys shrugged.
"He will be a loss to us."
"A loss," Lancaster repeated in a silken voice, looking at Ruck from beneath lazy eyelids.
"Well for thee that thou didst not leap at the command. Some here have counselled me that thou art a sly rebel, green sire, that thou hast kept thy name secret for something less than honour, and wormed thy way into a place, and gained the love of my men,
only to inflame disloyalty and rebellion with this spectacle today. That thou hast conspired with the princess to weaken us, in preparation for a French attack, tonight or tomorrow.
Ruck dropped to his knees.
Nay, my lord, by Almighty God!
Who stands behind the Princess Melanthe, traitor?
Knollys demanded.
I know not, Ruck exclaimed. I'm no traitor to you, my lord. I swear on my father's soul. Her man told me that she wished me to issue challenge in her name.
Against thy liege? Sir Robert demanded. And thou took her up?
My beloved lord, I meant you no insult. I was to challenge all comers. I am sworn to her. Years ago, and far from here, I knew not even her name until yesterday. I never thought to see her again. She was...
He paused.
I swore myself to her service. I know not why. It was long ago.
He shook his head helplessly.
I cannot explain it, my lord.
Lancaster lifted his brows.
Canst not explain it?
He burst out in caustic laughter and held his head.
Has she bewitched us or besotted us?
Send for the Inquisitor, his brother said. If she's a sorceress, he will discover it.
And Wiles?
There's no time for the Inquisitor.
Lancaster rested his head against the throne. Much as I should like to see her burn. He drew a deep breath and sighed.
But here, I find I cannot imprison or execute my green companion in arms. In spite of my aching head and dislocate joint, I have a fellow feeling for him, the love-struck ass. Moreover, it provokes riot.
Nor let him walk free, Knollys said.
Nor let him free, for if he wills or no, the men gather to him. And with the temper of the nobles, we'd have disorder enough to burn this city down. I want no rivals to my command. I need my men to fight France, not one another.
Ruck knelt silently, awaiting his fate, watching his future dissolve before his eyes. Lancaster gazed at him with that sleepy speculation.
Tell me, green sire, what is it thou hope to gain of me, to join my court?
My liege.
Ruck's voice trailed off. He had not envisioned that his moment with Lancaster would come this way.
Position? Lands? A fine marriage? I hear that the ladies admire thee.
Nay, Ruck lowered his face. I ask naught of you now, my lord.
And I offer naught, Lancaster said. For I want no more of thee. I have detained Princess Melanthe at the gate, so that thou wilt be seen alive and well to escort her into the city. At dawn thou must be off, with thy princess and all her train.
He smiled sourly.
And look thee to see me at the quay, to bid you both a cordial farewell.
It was for her protection, the message said. Melanthe pulled her cloak close about her in the cold darkness outside the city gate. Her little hunting entourage huddled before her. Behind lay the distant fires and tents of the tourniers, who had no lodging within the walls. That the gate was still open this late was strange. The guards were men in Lancaster's and the prince's livery, not the usual gatekeepers. She could see torches and hear drunken shouting from within. If she had had another choice, she would have turned away. The message and signs of riot inside were ominous. She did not think real trouble had erupted yet, but it might flare at any moment. Her presence alone might be enough to spark it. She much doubted that Lancaster's message to await an escort at the gate had been sent with loving concern for her safety. Gringolette fluffed her feathers to keep out the cold, perching quietly upon the saddle bow. The greyhound sat shivering. Melanthe had not dressed for darkness. Even in gauntlets, her fingers were cold. She looked into the blackness behind her, sparked by open fires, and admitted wryly to herself that nothing stopped her at the moment from fading into the gloom, as free as she dreamed of being, except for the mystery of how to live as anything but what she was.
My lady!
One of the guardsmen came striding from beneath the black bulk of the gatehouse over the bridge.
Your escort!
Even as he spoke, the arch brightened with the flare of many torches. At the head of a score of armed men, her green knight rode toward her beneath the gate. The torches behind him lit his mount's breath and his own in transparent gusts of frost. He wore no armor now, only a light helmet over a bandage that shone white across his forehead. The bridge thudded with the sound of hooves and boots. He never looked directly at her. With a perfunctory bow, he made a motion to the men to surround her horse. Placing half of the company before them and half behind, he wheeled his mount next to hers, swept his sword from its sheath, and shouted the order to march. She rode beneath the archway beside him. Inside the city walls, the streets were full of men. They stared and shouted and ran beside the company. Melanthe kept her eyes straight ahead and up. Her palfrey felt very small next to the destrier, and the score of men a thin wall against violence. In some of the side streets, other knights sat their mounts, swords unsheathed, staring malevolently as her escort passed. Limp bodies lay in doorways. Drunk or dead, she could not tell. The high bulk of the keep itself was a welcome sight, until she saw the crowd milling and pressing below it. As her escort came into view, a cheer went up, confounded with outrage and spiced by drink. The green sire shouted an order. The men ahead halted. He lifted his sword over his head, and the men-at-arms spun their sharpened pikes, forcing the nearest of the crowd to give room. The pikes stopped with their points at chest level, a bristle of protection. The castle gates opened slowly amid noise and disordered motion. He yelled another order, and the men-at-arms began to move, stabbing into the crowd ahead of them. In the light of the torches, her cavalcade pushed through the mob, encapsulated by pikesmen. The throng in the street could not seem to decide if they wished to cheer or resist, swarming back and forth in ill-tempered confusion, fighting one another, staggering back from the pikes, waving their own weapons in wild and abortive threats to their neighbors. Her palfrey danced along beside the warhorse, taking hopping, frightened steps, half rearing as a man fell between the pikes and sprawled in front of her. Melanthe gave the horse a quick spur, and it sprang off its haunches, coming down on the other side of the prone figure. The palfrey kicked out as it landed, but Melanthe did not turn to see if the blow struck. Allegretto's horse crowded behind her. The gate was overhead at last, and they were through, passing into the inner courtyard. The gates boomed closed behind them, shutting out a rising roar. Her knight dismounted and came to her, offering his knee and arm. Melanthe took his hand for support. Hers was shaking past her ability to control it. As her feet touched the ground, she said, "Thou tarried long in coming. I'm nigh frozen through." She did not wish him to think that she shivered from fear, nor did she thank him. She felt too grateful. She felt as if she would have liked to stand very close to him. He seemed so sure and sound, like the enclosing walls of the keep, a circle of sanctuary in the disorder. For that, she gave him a sweeping glance of disdain, and started to turn away.
"My lady," he said, "his lordship the Duke sends greeting and message, and desires to know that your hunting was well."
Melanthe looked back at him.
"Well enough," she said. "Two ducks. I will dispatch them to the kitchens. There is a message?"
"Yea, my lady."
He looked at her with an expression as opaque as a falcon's steady, cold stare.
"I am to escort you hence without delay. We leave at dawn, upon the tide."
"Ah!"
She smiled at him because he expected her to be shocked.
"We are cast out. Crude, but what does an Englishman know of subtlety? Indeed, this is excellent news. Thou shalt make all preparations for our departure to England, and attend my chamber at 2 hours before daybreak."
His face was grim. He bent his head in silent assent.
"The Duke has denied you, then?" she asked lightly.
Melanthe held out her hands in the flicker of torches.
"Green sire, swear troth to me now as liege, and I will love thee better."
His mouth grew harder, as if she offended him.
"My lady, I was sworn to your service long since. Your man I am, now and forever."
He held her eyes steadily.
"As for love, I need no more of such love as my lady's grace has shown me."
Melanthe raised her chin and shifted her look past him. Allegretto stood there, watching with a smirk. She bestowed a brilliant smile upon her courtier and lowered her hands.
Allegretto, come, my dear.
She shivered again, turning, pulling her cloak up to her chin.
I want my sheets well warmed tonight.
The boats rode the current and the outgoing tide downriver, their oars shipped and silent. As the banks of the Garonne slipped away, ever wider, a cold sun rose behind Ruck's little fleet, sucking the wind up the estuary off the sea. It was not to his taste, but he'd reckoned it his duty to sail aboard Princess Melanthe's vessel himself. He had worked with her steward all night to organize their departure. When he had seen the painted whirlycoat Princess Melanthe was to inhabit on the land journey, he'd found that he had to use the Duke's patent to commandeer an extra ship, only to convey the leather-covered four-wheeled house and the 5 horses necessary to draw it. Ruck had full believed that he would spend hours waiting on his liege lady's convenience, as she did not seem the sort to bestir herself to undue exertion, but Princess Melanthe's attendants outshone even the men-at-arms in their packing and loading efficiency. There was no scurrying back to fetch a lost comb or another pillow. Not one lady slipped away to linger in farewell with some broken-hearted lover. Ruck suspected that they feared their mistress too well to delay her. The Duke had come to see them off as he'd promised, making a great false show of giving the kiss of peace and offering cordial farewells. Ruck had found himself the object of more courtesy from his liege in the cold dawn of his departure than he had received in the whole sum of his years in service to Lancaster. The audience was small, only a few beggars and merchants, and a soldier or two woken from sleeping on the docks. But by noontide, the story would have spread throughout the city to the gentles and commoners alike. The Green Sire had left Aquitaine in Princess Melanthe's service, alive and without duress. No threat to Lancaster's command, no martyr to his pride, no spark to set rebellion alight. The Green Sire was nothing to Lancaster or to anyone else now. Ruck drew in a slow breath and let it go. He had lost his prince and liege. He had loved a lady who did not exist, but she had seemed so real, he had spent so long devoted to her, that he felt as if death had claimed a piece of his heart. He sat on deck atop the single high cabin in the stern, very aware of the princess below him. He wondered if she suffered from the seasickness, and had not sufficient imagination to picture such a thing. Pierre huddled in the tip of the stern, snoring gently. The wind blew in Ruck's face. His men lined the deck, sitting in the protection of the gunwales. He reached over and plucked his flute from Pierre's capacious apron. The squire opened one eye and then snugged into his cloak again. In the early light, Ruck began to play a sweet, mournful song of the Crusades, of a lover left behind to grief and worry. It seemed to him fit for the grey rise of dawn, slow and yearning, with the sway of the water and the glint of dull light on the helmets and crossbows. Fit for his mood, leaving nowhere, going nowhere. Below him, the curtain over the cabin door flicked. Ruck's note faltered for a bare instant, and then he lowered his eyes and went on playing. It was only her lapdog Allegretto who climbed the short stairs with a crimson cloak wrapped tight around him. To Ruck's concealed surprise, the youth sat down on the deck at his feet, facing away from him into the wind.
"That is a love song, is it not?" the young courtier asked.
Ruck ignored him, enclosing himself in the melody. Allegretto sat quietly for a few moments and then sighed. He looked around at Ruck.
"Hast thou ever been in love, Englishman?"
He asked it wearily, as if he were a century old. Ruck made no answer beyond his tune. Allegretto smiled, an expression that was undeniably charming in spite of his blackened eye. He pushed the wind-blown dark hair from his forehead.
"Of course, thou hast as many years as my lady, and she knows more of love than Venus herself."
He leaned back against the gunwale.
"Thou knowest she has magic to keep herself always the same. Perhaps she's 1,000 years old. Upon Hap, If thou wouldst see her in a mirror, she would be no more than a skull with black holes for eyes and nose.
Ruck lifted his brows skeptically, without losing the cadence of his notes. Allegretto laughed.
Ah, thou art too astute for me. Thou dost not believe it.
With an abrupt intensity, he leaned nearer. Thou wouldst not take her from me.
Ruck's music wavered for a beat.
Allegretto closed his eyes tightly.
Thou hast such as I cannot give her, he said in a lowered voice. I am not so young as I appear.
It took Ruck's mind a long moment to construct that into meaning. He lowered the flute. Allegretto pulled the red cloak up to his mouth and turned his head away. Ruck stared at the smooth, wind-pinkened cheek.
When I was 10 and 5,
Allegretto said, muffled, as if in answer to a question,
she preferred me thus.
He pulled the cloak closer and then glared over his shoulder.
But I still love her, he exclaimed fiercely. I can still love.
Ruck gazed at him. He could think of nothing more to do than nod in the face of such awful devotion. Allegretto held his eyes for a long moment, and then put his head down in his arms. Amid his shock, Ruck felt ashamed of himself. Whatever sacrifices he'd made in the name of his false lady, they had been honorable, and his own choice. He was a whole man. He wet his lips and picked up the flute again, taking refuge in the music. He had played only a few notes when two sharp thumps came from the deck beneath their feet. Allegretto looked up.
Oh,
he turned to Ruck and smiled sweetly.
I forgot. I was to order thee to cease that dirge and play something more amusing.
5. The old King of England was a haggard and drunken shadow of the tall warrior Melanthe remembered. Edward's regal progresses and tournaments lay as gemstones amid her childhood, all luster and polished steel and dazzling majesty. Her father's red and gold glistening among the other colours, sparks flying from his helmet at a hard strike, her mother's fingers tightening for an instant over Melanthe's hand. King Edward drank a long swallow of wine and handed the cup aside hastily, gesturing his servant behind his chair when Melanthe entered his royal bedchamber. The king's grey hair lay loose over the broad shoulders that once had borne armour, his moustaches flowing down into his long beard. He had the reddened nose and cheeks of too much drink, but he kept a regal posture in his chair. A day in London had been ample time for Melanthe to discover that he was in utter thrall to his mistress, a fine female of a stamp that Melanthe understood full well. No one attended the king without consent of the feared and hated Lady Alice, and Melanthe was no exception. Alice Perrers sailed into the chamber on her heels.
"I bring you someone you will like, my dear,"
Lady Alice said, plucking the goblet from the servant's hand. She leaned over the king's chair and kissed his forehead as she poured him more wine. He smiled dreamily at the ample bosom hovering so near his face.
"Here is Lady Melanthe, the daughter of Lord Richard of Boland, God give his soul rest. She bears gifts for you, and letters from Bordeaux. The Duke writes."
"John!"
The king's eyes brightened. He held out both his hands. His fingers shook. Melanthe made a deep curtsy. She rose, giving Lady Alice a significant look, before she moved forward to make her offerings. The mistress had fattened her unofficial power so far that it was said she even sat upon the benches and threatened the justices. But Melanthe could play that game. She had lavished compliments and gifts upon this overripe and overblown person, along with hints that their interests were quite compatible. Lady Alice would not wish any powerful man, most particularly someone like John of Lancaster, to marry Melanthe and combine their great estates into a domain that would challenge the king's. No more did Melanthe care to marry such a man, she had assured Lady Alice. She had no ambitions beyond her father's inheritance. Her greatest desire was to pay her levies to the king so that he might be enriched, and thus more generous yet in bestowing suitable presents upon his favourites. In her excess of goodwill,
Melanthe herself would make a generous present to the king's intimates the moment a private audience might be arranged. Of course, if a private audience was impossible, if Lady Alice did not trust her new friend, then in Melanthe's crushing disappointment and hurt, she feared that she must return in disgrace to Aquitaine, where his lord's grace the Duke had been most flattering in his attentions. Lady Alice gave Melanthe a narrow smile as she straightened from bending over the king. With much petting and many careless endearments, she withdrew. He retained her hand in a lamentably fatuous manner, but when she finally departed, leaving only the chamberlain, Alice's man, and the servant, Edward seemed to forget her, leaning forward in his eagerness for his son's letter. Melanthe made another curtsy and gave him Lancaster's missive. She could have recited it to him, having made herself free with the wax seal before they had left Bordeaux. She watched the king frown over his eldest son's poor health, and quicken at the news that the prince would return home to recover. She saw Edward's mouth purse at the report of the empty treasury in Aquitaine, and the uneasy temper of the Gascon nobles. The tournament went unmentioned in the letter, as did the green sire and Lancaster's shoulder, and the Duke's soured courting of Melanthe. Lancaster merely recommended her to his father's favour as the daughter of a loyal and beloved subject, suggesting that she be confirmed in her inheritance with all due haste, a forbearance that spared everyone, including himself, considerable embarrassment. Melanthe was greatly in charity with the Duke at present.
"Richard of Boland! God assoil him!"
Edward exclaimed with pleasure in his voice. He bade Melanthe rise and gave her a wine-balmed embrace.
"Child! And our John has sent you to us. Tell us of him. In truth, how does he?"
He held out the paper with a sad sigh.
"This speaks not a word of himself."
"My very dear and mighty lord, your son was in great good humour when I took leave of him. May God defend," she said.
He nodded, pleased, and then seemed to lose the course of his thought as he stared off into a corner. After a long moment, he tilted his head toward her, as if he were a child with a secret.
"The prince is our pride," he whispered, "but John is our heart."
Melanthe murmured, "The Duke has much the look of his dear mother, the Queen. God give her soul rest." Melanthe had no idea if this was so, having only the haziest recollection of Queen Philippa as a plump and smiling personage, but she added,
"He has her eyes, my lord, a very fine figure of a man. Your Majesty may well love him with a full heart."
Edward's lips trembled.
"Verily, verily,"
he gave a deep sniff,
"you are a good and lovely child. What can we do for you?"
Melanthe bowed, placing a lavishly bound volume upon his bed.
"My lord would honour me. Would you accept this small gift? It is a work upon falconry, written by a master from the North Country."
At Edward's impatient gesture, the king's servant passed the book to him. He turned the leaves, nodding in delight.
"A most worthy subject for a treatise. Excellent, excellent. We are pleased."
Melanthe drew him into a little discussion of hunting birds. After a quarter hour they were great friends. He was well known to have a passion for falconing and hawking.
"And this, sire," she said when she felt the moment right, "I would convey into your own hand, if you will consent."
She held out a sealed parchment. King Edward accepted the paper, fumbling it open.
"What is this, my dear?"
"It is my claim to my husband's estate, quitted into your name, my beloved lord. I am a weak woman. I have not the power to assert it myself, but it is a most valuable right. My husband was the Prince of Monteverde. He had no male heirs to survive him, and I myself have a claim through my mother's blood. All of it I cede to my mighty and esteemed lord, to do with as your Majesty might will."
Melanthe was aware of the Chamberlain's subtle stir at this news. He stood close to the king, bowing.
"May I read the document to you, sire?"
The Chamberlain's greedy hand was already upon the quitclaim, but Edward's fingers closed. He held to the document.
"Monteverde!"
His vague old eyes seemed to sharpen.
"We are in debt to Monteverde for a certain sum."
My lord, I did not know of such a thing.
Melanthe lied, dropping into a deep curtsy. Edward was in debt by an impossible amount to the Bank of Monteverde, as he was and had always been in debt to the Italian money merchants.
Then I may have even greater hope that my humble gift is of value to my king.
Alice's man made another attempt, not so subtle, to divest Edward of the quitclaim, but the king held it tightly.
You have not asserted your right?
He frowned.
Nay, but our mind betrays us. Boland, have you not a brother to act for you? Lionel's friend.
He paused, his voice trailing off into an old man's quiver. Melanthe could see him remember. He had peddled his second son Lionel to the Viscontis of Milan in a payment for England's debts, but the most lavish wedding of the age, with gifts of armour and horses and hounds in gemmed collars, cloaks of ermine and pearls, a banquet of 30 courses all gilded with gold leaf, and a dowry so huge it had taken 2 years to barter, had not bought a long and happy life for Lionel. He had died 6 months later, in Italy, of an unnamed fever. And with him, Richard, of his closest inner circle, Richard, her brother, who had been only 5 when Melanthe had left England, and a stranger of 21 when he came to Italy to die. The gossips had said that he had been slain mistakenly by sharing poisoned drink with Lionel. The gossips had said that Richard had meant to kill his own prince, and accidentally killed himself as well. The gossips had said that Melanthe had murdered her brother for his inheritance, uncaring that the prince died with him. The gossips said anything. She watched the king with her heart beating hard.
May God give both of their souls reprieve.
Edward's broad shoulders were drawn inward, his lower lip unsteady. He groped for the wine goblet and drank.
Amen.
She made the cross, drawing a deep breath.
My lord, in my woman's frailty, I have not the courage or desire to act upon my claim to Monteverde. I wish only to return to Boland and live there unmolested in my widowhood, if it please you. But a man of greater energy and shrewdness than my poor self, sire, such a man as the Duke of Lancaster, say, a lord of your son's natural powers might make a great and useful thing of this claim.
Verily, the king wiped his eyes, verily.
Your Majesty must wish to give the Duke much, in return for his dedication to his brother's interests in Aquitaine,
Melanthe murmured. King Edward began to weep at this mention of his son's unswerving loyalty. God knew Lancaster was truly faithful to his family, bankrupting his own coffers as he was in trying to hold Aquitaine together in their name. For a moment, Melanthe feared she had gone too far, that this talk of his son's would send Edward back into maudlin foolishness. But the Chamberlain took advantage of the moment to get his claws upon the quitclaim again. The king, roused, shaking off his retainer's obtrusive hand with royal contempt, showing a gleam of his former spirit as he stared down at the document with a narrow-eyed examination. They shall not have it, Ligurio. Melanthe smiled inside herself, her teeth grinding together. Not Alice Perez, or Riata, or Navona either. Pray God and fortune King Edward had resolve enough left in him that he would turn her quitclaim over to his favourite son instead of Alice's brood, and the wolves of Italy would find John of Lancaster in their midst after all. Fair payment it would be to him, she thought, for the dislocate shoulder and humiliation she had caused. By hap, some day he would even thank her. The king looked up at her, his eyes red.
What can we do to show our fondness for you, child?
Sire, she said, bowing her head, my only wish is that I may live alone at Boland. My marriage is in your Majesty's gift.
You would not be pleased to wed again?
Nay, sire, by your leave. In hap, in the fullness of time, at God's hest, I will enter a nunnery and devote myself to prayer.
The king nodded, gripping the quitclaim.
So be it. You have our pledge, child. In our affection for you, we shall not require you to marry again. Also, we desire that you hold the dignity of your father's offices,
in the style of Countess of Boland and all other titles with which he was invested.
He waved a shaky hand toward the Chamberlain.
See, these things are so affirmed by our seal.
Bowing down unto the very floor, Melanthe abandoned the king to Alice's tender avarice. It was vital now to leave London instantly, before Allegretto or the Reata could discover what she had done. She acted by Ligurio's teaching. She kept her goal clear, but the path to reach it shifted on the edge of a moment. She felt freedom near. On the high, empty hills she remembered from her northern childhood she would live, belonging to no one but herself. Of all her father's rich and comfortable manors, she chose cold Boland Castle as her citadel, as he had done. If she could command Monteverde for the 6 years of Ligurio's dying, she could hold her father's lands from Boland, vast though they might be, among these simple-headed Englishmen. The course she would take to attain her end was still uncertain, but she lived moment to moment as she must. Allegretto was well distracted from his usual vigilance. She had made sure of that before her audience with the king. But how long his fear would divert him, she did not know. Always she watched for opportunity, seized on a different ruse, twisted and turned as she saw her chance or felt her danger. She had betrayed every bargain and vow with her quitclaim. Now she lived like quicksilver, breath to breath, until she could rid herself of her watchdogs. London was full of plague rumours. At Princess Melanthe's command, Ruck tracked hearsay through the muddy streets. When he presented himself to attend her at Westminster Palace, Allegretto assailed him in her anteroom. "What befalls?" the youth demanded, trailing Ruck to her steward. Allegretto had a morbid fear of plague. He talked of it endlessly, and had taken to attaching himself to Ruck whenever he was at the palace, as if Ruck had some talisman against it.
"Naught befalls that I can tell," Ruck said.
"Naught?" Allegretto asked anxiously.
Ruck held out his hand toward the door as the steward announced him.
"Am I to report to thy mistress or to thee, whelp?"
"To me, certainly."
The princess's voice was elegant and firm. She lowered the book of poetry to her lap.
"My liege lady."
Ruck bowed, while Allegretto hovered by his elbow like an importunate child.
"Green sire,"
she acknowledged courteously. She was much more sedate in her manner among the English, dressed with rich propriety in blue and white, only a few diamonds sparkling in her necklace and belt. A changeling, taking on the aspect of her surroundings. He felt his own weakness, succumbing to this false look of virtue, when he knew the corrupt truth of her.
"You come with what news?" she asked.
"I find no evidence of any epidemic here, Your Highness."
She nodded.
"Well enough. It is only gossip as usual, you see, Allegretto."
She laid aside the book and gave a little stretch.
"I fear you must leave me now to rest. The sea journey still fatigues me."
Ruck started to withdraw, but Allegretto hung on to his arm.
"Nay, the truth," Allegretto demanded. "What dost thou know?"
Ruck frowned at him.
"I've said truth. There's no plague in the city."
"Do not conceal it."
Allegretto flung himself onto the bed.
"My lady, he must speak. Dost thou hide something, sir?" she asked sharply.
Ruck prevented himself from looking directly at her. Out of her presence it was possible to feel disgust, but the sight of her overpowered his better reason. A vision of her had haunted him for 10 and 3 years. The reality cut through illusions to the heart of impure hunger. Her new modesty only made it the worse. He knew more of her, but not enough. He feared that everything could not be enough.
"There is no plague," he repeated. "It is but gossip."
Princess Melanthe tilted her head.
"But you believe it will come?"
"How can I know? There's talk of the planets aligned for it."
This news turned Allegretto white.
"My lady!"
"There's little enough to that," Ruck said. "I vow the planets predict plague once a month. The astrologers make their living on such gloom."
"Nay,"
Allegretto turned to Princess Melanthe.
"My lady's charts say the same." "Thou must be careful, love," she said. "Very careful. I've cast thy stars again. they exert an ill chance now.
In Bordeaux they said it had returned in the south, Allegretto exclaimed.
Not in Milan, she said soothingly. The talk there was that it raged among the Danes.
Mayhap it is all talk, Ruck said.
Traders will bring it from the north, in death ships.
Allegretto hurled himself off the bed.
Lady, let us fly.
Fly where? She asked calmly.
Away!
His voice had a frantic undertone.
Out of the city!
And suppose it follows us out of the city? She smiled at him. Perhaps thou wilt be fortunate to meet the Heavenly Father while thou art still young and innocent. The youth made a faint sound, falling to his knees before her. He buried his face against her skirt. Ruck had begun to feel a certain compassion for Allegretto. The indifferent way she mocked his mortal fears might have seemed casual, but Ruck had caught the small, cruel narrowing of her eyes as she looked down at her youthful lover. At that instant, it was as if she hated him. But then her mouth softened, and she ruffled his hair. "Fly, then, if it pleases thee," she said. "Return home to Monteverde." He lifted his face quickly.
"Your Highness, we go home."
"Not I, but I will send thee to safety. Thy father will shield thee in his country villa." Allegretto stared at her, his fingers gripped in the folds of her dress.
"Nay, lady!"
She traced her fingers down his face. "Go home. I could not bear to see thy sweet skin swell and blacken," she murmured. "I could not bear to hear thy groans." His breath came faster. His tongue ran around his lips.
"We will go home together, lady. My father will give refuge to us both."
"I've had audience with the king. Wilt thou deny me my lands that he commends to me?"
"But the plague!"
She gave a slight laugh. "There is some privilege in age, my lovely boy. Does it not strike most terribly at the young and handsome such as thee?" He shook his head, holding her embroidered hem pressed to his mouth.
"I cannot leave you, your Highness."
"The stars augur ill for thee. Wilt thou compel me to follow thy bier?" He gave a dry sob.
"You know I cannot leave you, lady. But let us fly from this city, I beg you."
She sat back, glancing a question at Ruck.
"As soon as your Highness likes to venture forth," he said bluntly. "But the weather is untoward. We were fortunate in our water crossing. To the north, they say, the winter already holds hard, and it were wiser to take time to assemble a large escort for my lady's protection."
Allegretto raised his face, wiping fiercely at the tears that tumbled down his cheeks.
"Please, lady, no delay."
"How long to softer weather?" she asked Ruck.
3 months, say."
3 months!
Allegretto cried. He reached for Princess Melanthe's hand and squeezed it between his.
"I'll be dead in 3 months. I feel it."
She looked down at him for a long moment. His eyes seemed to grow wider, almost fearful, as he held her gaze. "I am in no hurry to leave," she said indifferently. "The journey will discommode me." He suddenly snatched his hands away and flung himself from her.
"You taunt me!" he shouted. "We'll not stay here, or I'll write to my father."
"Little use if thou art to be dead in 3 months." Princess Melanthe picked up her book and turned a page idly. "With luck he might arrive to pray over thy coffin." Allegretto seized the book. He ripped out half the vellum, scattering it across the carpets, as if the precious leaves were but wheaten chaff. When Princess Melanthe made no reaction, his face seemed to transfigure, altering from smooth beauty to a demon's mask of rage. He leaned over her, grabbed her cheeks between his palms and kissed her, crushing his mouth against hers. Ruck saw her hands clench white on the arms of the chair as the youth bore her head hard back against the carved rest. Ruck grabbed Allegretto's shoulder and hauled him off. With one shove, he sent the youth sprawling backward against the tapestried wall.
"Master thyself!"
He held Allegretto by the throat, pressing him to the wall.
"Ere thou findest a grave sooner yet."
Allegretto swallowed beneath his hand, breathing hard.
He looked at Ruck with black eyes that had gone empty, as if fear and fury had cancelled each other. The sound of light clapping came from behind. "A most knightly performance, green sire. The poor child only wants manners. Haps thou might give him a lesson at thy leisure."
"Tell my lady," Allegretto said between panting breaths, "tell my lady's grace to think of how she will grieve, should I die."
Ruck let him go and stepped back.
"This lies between thee and thy mistress."
He cast her a hard glance, then bowed.
"I await your decision without, madam."
She lifted her hand to bid him stay.
"That will not be required. We shall be civilized, shall we not, Allegretto? Begin the preparations to depart for Boland at once, sir."
"Tomorrow, by secluded ways,"
Allegretto said, quick and hoarse,
"if it please my lady's grace."
She made an impatient flick of her hand.
"As thou wilt, then. We take only what men-at-arms you have at present, sir. The rest of my court may follow with my baggage. It will be safer to avoid peopled places, should pestilence somehow run ahead of us."
"Nay, only for his fancy?" Ruck asked in outrage. "Your Highness, such a small party, it be naught protection enough."
"Allegretto wishes to avoid plague."
"Plague is not the only danger to your Highness," he said harshly, "or the likeliest for that matter."
Her lashes lifted.
"And what is likelier, sir? Canst thou not master such bandits as the countryside boasts?"
He scowled.
"My lady, I think not of outlaws only."
"Of what, then?" she demanded.
"Your Highness holds great wealth and property," he said brusquely.
"Ah, it is my abduction you fear. Well thought, green sire, but I have no apprehension of it. Our departure will be quick and quiet, and if we travel by uncommon ways, so much the better to foil any such schemes."
She smiled.
"And of course, you may spread word that any man who forces me to wed him will rue every day of his short life, and die in lingering agony."
Ruck gazed at her. She was so beautiful and so wicked, laughing at him behind that comely, innocent smile. It would work, he thought with resentful wonder. Between her reputation and her plan to slip away, she would be near as safe from seizure and force as if she travelled with 500,000 men. He bowed his head.
"My lady," he assented grudgingly, "as you say."
Allegretto gave a deep sigh and closed his eyes. He stood against the wall, fresh tears trickling down his cheeks. The pulse in his throat hammered visibly. Ruck's own heart still thudded with reaction. He had seen little of Princess Melanthe and her courtier so far on the journey. He hoped that he would see little more, if this was to be the way of it. He disliked scenes and ravings intensely. 6.
"Wen, Tway, Thren, Hai!"
Ruck yelled, driving Hawk forward, dragging at the lead horse's bridle as the line went taut over his saddle bow. The animals threw their heads, blowing great puffs of frost, heaving and struggling as their hooves sank half to the knee in ice water and mud. Easy enough for the Princess Melanthe to choose to avoid lodging on the way north. She and her attendants sat in the whirlycoat, lumbering monster that it was, without even lifting the leather cover to watch. Ruck let the line go lax and backed Hawk again, turning in the saddle to look down the line of 5 blowing horses to his men wrestling with the tree limbs braced beneath the wheels. The whirlycoat's proud paint and glitter was a sad sight now, covered in dirt, drowned to the axles in the ruts. His sergeant-at-arms, standing to the side and peering underneath, shook his head and straightened. He held up his arm for another try. Ruck turned again.
"Owen! Tway!"
As the whirlycoat rocked thrice in time, the men chorused in with Ruck's shout, maintaining a miserably determined enthusiasm.
"High up!"
Hawk bowed his grey head and strained. The harnessed horse reared against the yoke and came down with a splash of frigid water that sprayed over Ruck's leg. Shouts erupted behind him. The whirlycoat pitched mightily